Now live.
Thank you, and good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to the second part of this meeting of Worcestershire County Council. And we start with agenda item 5B, report of the Cabinet, decisions taken. This report deals with decisions already taken by the Cabinet and references pages 17 to 20. And I would remind you that specific questions may be asked about items in the report. This is an opportunity to ask relevant questions, not make speeches on matters which have already been decided. The reports will be taken section by section. There will be no returning to previous sections or pages. And questions will be restricted to a maximum 2 minutes per item per councillor. So please ask your question clearly and concisely. And if necessary, written replies will be provided by the leader or the relevant cabinet member. So we begin with Report of the Cabinet. The first was section one, annual update to the school organisation plan. And that's questions for Mr. Hart, please. Mr. Hart is there, is he? I can't see him on my screen. Are you there, Mr.
Yes,
Hart?
I'm definitely here, Chairman.
Oh, good. Sorry, I didn't want to get your questions if you weren't there to answer them. So okay, I'm seeing some hands coming up then for questions on section one. And Mr. Roberts, please.
Thank you, Chairman. First, before I ask a question, can I thank Councillor Hart and indeed Councillor Geraghty for helping and pave the way for a new secondary school for the east side of Worcester, which is fantastic news. The question is, it seems to have been done under the radar and local people haven't been, I don't seem to be aware of it. Are there any plans to make this wonderful news more public?
Thank you. Andy, that's an interesting take because, of course, we did do an official press release and the report did go to our 4th February cabinet meeting in public. And we certainly don't want to hold our light under a bushel when we are promoting good news. In fact, I have had contact with one or two local stakeholders to ask me some information about the school. So whilst, of course, the exact location, whilst we seek to purchase the land by private treaty needs to be under the radar, there's absolutely no reason why we shouldn't celebrate and explain to our wider community as to the proposals of a new secondary school for Worcester. And I'll rely on the local members in Worcester. I know there's a job interview coming up on the first Thursday in May, and I know that you certainly won't be shy in coming forward in rejoicing in this excellent news to the good residents, and importantly, the young people of Worcester, who at the moment struggle to get in a local secondary school, whereas due to the sufficiency overall not being enough, and that really is a serious point, and we shouldn't hide away from that. And please feel free to spread the good news.
Thank you. And I just see two more hands up. I'll take two more questions then. One from Mr. Middleborough and then one from Mr. Oodle. Mr. Middleborough.
Thank you, Chairman. Could the Cabinet Member assure me that for the South Worcestershire development expansion, which is going to take place in Kempsey, and there will be a new primary school in Kempsey in addition to the existing primary school, that students from that new primary school, when it opens, will be able to attend a Worcester High School, given that traditionally they've had to travel the 20 miles every day from Kempsey to Hanley Castle High School. But given the new walking arrangements and footbridges over the Southern Link, it will be wonderful if those students are able to attend a high school in Worcester within walking or cycling distance from home.
Thank you, and I've got a second question. Mr. Oodle, please.
Thank you, Chair, and I will give this opportunity to the Cabinet Member to answer the same question I asked at Cabinet so it can get a wider airing. This is certainly to be welcomed, a new secondary school for Worcester, new high school, and I think that would be help to resolve a lot of local issues in the city regarding school admittance. But my question is, obviously all new schools have to be free schools, and can we therefore work with any partners to ensure that there is no selection permitted for any new schools, either on the grounds of faith or ability?
Yeah, let's have a grammar, yeah.
Thank you for those. That's two questions.
Thank you. Even heckling in the background. Okay, right. First question. Yes, Councillor Middlebrook, I absolutely don't see why not. As you know, our political party and indeed this council believes in choice and parental choice for parents, and we believe in sustainability and active travel. Why on earth would we want youngsters to have to get on a bus and travel 20 miles when they can walk or cycle and get to a closer high school? I know, of course, that there has been some concerns, and I know that Malvern and Hanley Swan head teachers would want to be reassured that we weren't taking pupils away from their school. I don't think that will happen. Pupils and parents will vote with their feet. And as we look forward over the South Worcestershire urban expansion over the next decade or so, you know, if I was to look into my crystal ball, you know, in a decade plus, we won't need one, we'll need two secondary schools. So I think there will be great local provision for youngsters. And yes, I agree with you, Councillor Middlebrook. Councillor Udall, I thought you might ask me this question. Let me try and rehearse the same answer. You know, and to be fair, you have alluded to it must be opened as a free academy school. Paragraph 28 on page 118 of the Cabinet report sets out the free school presumption process. It will give us some control as a local authority. We know, and there's an academy that you may or may not be referring to in Worcester that has a certain admissions process. But the reality, academies do have the power to set their own admissions. And in terms of selection, of course, it depends on what you mean by it, because there does have to be a criteria. You know, if a school has X number of pupils as a ceiling in it, and it only has 120 places in a year, yet has 220 applicants, there has to be some form of selection, whether it's sibling, whether it's looked after child, whether it's straight line distance to the school. But I get the point that you make. And in fact, in respect to my other report in terms of admission arrangements, the diocese are moving of Worcester are moving away from you know, selection in terms of religion, and therefore I don't think you've too much to worry about there. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, and I'm seeing another hand up, Mr. McDonald. Is this still section one?
Yes, this is to do with the schools, Mr. Chairman. Not only is Worcester to have a new school, but I've been led to believe Coughton in my ward will be having a new school shortly. My concern, as well as that's been aired about the admission policy, is when what happens when the students actually get into the school. And what I want is some assurance from this county council that they will work with the new schools, as they should be with the academies, to stop this drift in the schools of employing unqualified teachers. I don't think the majority of parents realise just what's going on nowadays with the increase. Could be because of budget pressures. We're having more and more unqualified teachers fronting classes, which can't be helping any good for our, I wouldn't think, for our student pupils. So could have the insurance that this authority will work with the new schools, and indeed they should be with the academies, to ensure that they actually employ qualified teachers.
You, Mr. Hart.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Councillor McDonald never misses a trick. Any broad theme about education, and he wants to weave in a matter that has nothing to do with the Cabinet report and nothing to do with what is on the order paper. This is school organisational planning, so I will just ignore his comments because they are not part of the order paper. But let me say, and he talks about Coughton Hackett, I think he's referring to Wasley Hills High School, and let's rejoice that both Prince Henry's and Wasley Hills have had the grant direct from the DfE for brand new school buildings, which is excellent news for the pupils in those local communities, Mr. Chairman. I do thank Councillor McDonald for raising his thanks to the government for this capital investment in our Worcestershire children.
It seems that you must be thicker than I think. There's a new school coming in Coughton, which has been approved by the government, which will be a free school.
Mr. McDonald, I think we just need to tone it down a little bit, please.
Well, Mr. Chairman, I'm going to move on to section two. Do you have any questions? Not me. He's saying I don't think
derogatory remarks about another councillor are how we should be doing, business in this county.
I tell you, if his brains was greased, he couldn't grease a frying pan.
Mr. McDonald, can we have no more of this, please? And now I'll move on to section two, again for Mr. Hart, school admission arrangements. I'm not seeing any hands there, so I assume there are no questions. Okay, I'll move on to section three. Do we have any questions? Section three, please. Yes, I can see hands going up. And this is a review of day opportunities for adults with learning difficulties, paragraphs 7 to 19, and Mr. Hardman to respond. So a question from Ms. Agar, please.
Thank you, Chair. I'm looking at paragraphs 7 to 9, which tell us that the dividing line between two services have become blurred, and that's the resource centres, I think, and the Connect service. My experience of various organisations tells me that often this happens when organisations are trying to do too much with too little, and you try to be a jack of all trades, and your business process gets distorted. So I'm a bit concerned about this, and I'm worrying about, I see that there's a review going on, which is very welcome. So I'm hoping that after the review, at a suitable period, there will be an audit to see that the business process is being answered and that the offer is what is needed. Is that going to happen?
Thank you. And could I also take a question from Mr. Fry, please?
Thank you, Chair. just to ask the cabinet member, it's good to see a review of day services for adults with learning disabilities. And as he knows, many of the people that I support usually would access day services. What's the latest update on the services, the day services for people with learning disabilities?
Thank you, Mr. Hardman. Would you like to respond, please?
Thank you very much, Chairman. I have to say, I do agree with Councillor Agar's suggestion that we should have an audit at the end of this of business process practice, which I think is extremely sensible. If I could refer her to read the, I don't know if she has, and I'm rather presuming because of the nature of her question, she probably hasn't. If she reads the full report that was sadly, in my view, attached in appendix 1 or 2 to the cabinet papers, she will see the detail that we are driving down to with this. But I do think at the end of this, there is a lesson to be learned for those who are on the front line, advising families on the decision-making that they have to undertake and the users have to undertake to ensure that people are going to the correct service. Because, I mean, we do actually have cases where people are going to both styles of service, which seems very strange to me. Part of this review, of course, also is this question of further integration with the health offer is absolutely vital, but that's mainly for the resource centres. I hope that answer makes sense to you. But this is turning out to be a far bigger task and far more complex than we initially thought. Andy, just to answer your question, I'm afraid to say the contact centres are still all closed during lockdown, but our resource centres, I think, are all open now and are able to operate in a COVID-secure way. Because I suspect your follow-up question would be, you know, I fully understand the pressure this puts on families. You know, it's been, for some families, nearly a whole year now. And it's been a considerable burden on them. A considerable amount of extra work. Perhaps not a burden would be the right word.
Okay, thank you, Adrian.
Thank you very much. I'm not seeing any more hands for that one. So move on to section 4, scrutiny report. That's paragraphs 11 and 12. No, not seeing any hands going up there. So I'll move us on then to section 5, corporate landlord and facilities management delivery model. That's paragraphs 13 to 15. Do we have any questions on that one, please? No, I'm not seeing any hands. So we're finished with that item then, and we'll move to agenda item 6, report of cabinet member with responsibility. Please turn to pages 21 to 43 to consider a report from the cabinet member with responsibility for highways, Mr. Alan Amos. The cabinet member has been asked to keep his introduction to a minimum to allow maximum time for questions. And I will take questions in batches of three before asking the cabinet member to respond. Members are reminded that a maximum of 30 minutes is permitted for questions and answers on this report. I would therefore ask that questions are kept to the point. And I will invite Mr. Amos to present his report, after which I will invite questions from members on a section by section basis and ask that members indicate which paragraph their question refers to. I think we're all conscious that this is a long report, and therefore we're proposing to, with the agreement of the various leaders, that we will actually start with page 23, paragraphs 12 to 17. But Mr. Amos, did you want to present your report?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chair. I'll be as brief as possible. In introducing this report, I would remind Council that this time just a year ago, highways were dealing with some of the worst floods on record as we went into the unknown of the first ever lockdown. A year later, we have just dealt with some of the worst floods on record, plus snow and ice, whilst in a third national lockdown. I mention this to highlight the vicissitudes of running a highways network. Even my report of 23 pages, the largest on record, I'm told, Mr. Chairman, is a snapshot of the work that goes on. Elsewhere today, I've highlighted and will highlight the record levels of investment in all sectors. But I hope the report shows how proactive and imaginative the department has been in tackling both the immediate and long-term challenges. For example, one consequence of the pandemic is the permanent increase and interest in walking. So our decisive response has been to double our spending on public rights of way. We've cleared off long-standing issues, for example, installing a new pedestrianised crossing at Croft Road and Asda in Worcester City. About to take over the responsibility for bus shelters, given that the shared arrangements with the district are not working well or at all at the moment. Taking on the role of enforcing the Lowsmoor bus lane, because the City Council as enforcement authority could not or did not want to do it. Using a TRO to improve the public realm, such as extending the hours of the ban on vehicles and cycling from the pedestrianised city centre to now between 10 a.m. and 6 p.m. When it comes to speeding, given members the funding and power to erect VAS speed cameras in the absence of any enforcement by the police. Extending the Members' Capital Highways Fund to make members effective decision makers in their own divisions for minor and major schemes. Keeping schemes under review, such as grip bins, and improving others, such as gully cleaning and jetting, where we're about to introduce a completely new system so members and the public will, for the first time, be able to access full information to identify problem gullies and feed this information back to the centre, who can then immediately identify the specific problem, thereby providing a more efficient service for everyone. And finally, Mr. Chairman, something which will bring about a dramatic improvement in dealing with utilities, roadworks and traffic congestion, the introduction of a lane rental scheme to slash the time roads are being dug up by hitting the utilities in their pockets if they aren't efficient and don't minimise the congestion they cause. And of course, there's nothing more unique than our own liaison engineers, whom we have all come to know and love. I thank our staff, all of our staff, and those at Ringway, Mr. Chairman, for their tireless commitment, literally out in all weathers, always on the front line, and for their extraordinary ability to put up with me. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Amos. And I see three hands up, so I'll take three questions to start. And this is communication with members of the general public, paragraphs 12 to 17, please. And so Mrs. Zaborski, Mr. Denham, and then Mrs. Hodgson. So Mrs. Zaborski, please.
Right, I'd like to thank the cabinet member for his report. I've got a specific question on paragraph 12, because Councillor Rayner and I have had a remote meeting with our standing highways liaison officer, but this is the first time I've read anywhere that we were supposed to be having weekly meetings. So if any have been going on in the Wild Forest area on a weekly basis, I certainly haven't been invited. I am concerned that on several occasions recently, I've sent photos into the stand-in liaison engineer and have been promised that inspectors will go out urgently and will and will contact me again. And I've never heard anything back. And also, I had a site meeting with an office, a gentleman from Ringway last week, and I had never heard of our highways liaison engineers being referred to as Chloe's before. He completely floored me when he said, have you spoken to your Chloe, which I gather is County Highways Liaison Officer. But certainly I've never heard them called Chloes before. I don't know if others have. But as I said, I do have some concerns about how much we're actually being in contact with liaison engineers.
Thank you. And can I just ask members to keep their questions short if they can? And Mr. Denham, please. Mr. Denham? You're on mute.
Oh. Sorry, can you hear me now?
Yes, we hear you now.
Good, thank you. Sorry, I did press the thing. It didn't work. Apologies for that. Mine's about communication as well. If the cabinet member's so keen on good communication with members, as is stated, then why is it that when he knows that this report, we've only got half an hour to go ask questions on it, that he's cancelled the members' briefing next week, as I was intending to attend with other members from Worcester, because that reduces the amount of communication, the ability to question what's going on. And can he also say why he's put the public transport and walking and cycling sections of his report right at the end, when he knows that the chances of us having much discussion on it in a half-hour period are very much reduced? It would be more helpful if that could have been further ahead in the report, so there's a reasonable chance of asking some questions about it.
Thank you. And Mrs. Hodgson, please.
I would like to praise the work of the Chloes in Hannah Davis. We know we're lucky in Malvern. We do meet on a regular basis monthly, and she services us very, very well and is a very good conduit for speaking with the public, bringing other officers together. And recently we have had some very, very successful meetings with other parts of highways. And also we did have a very successful meeting when everyone came together, Alan chaired it, and was able to hear our concerns. We do have issues, but we feel very safe that they are being sensibly looked after. I have to say a big hand clap to Hannah for doing a fantastic job.
Thank you. Mr. Amos, would you like to respond, please?
If I can remember all those questions, Mr. Chairman. Yeah, the first one from Councillor Borski. I can't obviously comment on particular details of things that may or may not have been followed up, but certainly I will invite her to let me know directly of any issues she has, and I will obviously get those looked into and no doubt sorted. I think we just need to be a little bit patient, though. We do have one or two health issues with one or two of our liaison engineers, and we have a vacancy for which we've advertised twice, and we're going out to advert again for the third time. So I think while we rearrange the arrangements, Mr. Chairman, we are doing our best to cover everything. So I think people just need to be a little bit patient and tolerant, but any specific issues, as always, and I say this to all members, please contact me direct, because I'm pretty sure that the vast majority I can sort out with the relevant officer. Councillor Denham, I think it's a bit churlish to complain about these kinds of things. I have initiated members' briefings. We have these twice a year for each particular district, so any member can come along, raise any issue, operational, policy, or anything they like. We have a full complement of officers at these meetings. These are new meetings that didn't exist before I took over as cabinet member, and these are twice a year. I can't remember or how often Councillor Denham has attended them, but I do urge him to attend, because this is where any questions and issues can be raised. As for the specific issue of the members' briefing next week, I do think it was a bit churlish to ask officers to prepare a second report within a week of my having doing a cabinet member report for council, Mr. Chairman. So we have to think of the burden on officers. Those meetings have got to be properly briefed and prepared. And it wasn't right to ask officers to provide a second one, although obviously I'm responsible for producing this one myself. And again, I do think it's a little bit churlish and childish to say something is at the end and something isn't. if something has to be at the end, as it happens on this occasion, it's the budget, because we dealt with the budget this morning. If Councillor Denner wants to move something up the list, then can he tell us what he wants to move down the list? But the idea that we haven't had very full and extensive and frequent discussions on active travel and cycling, I think would be completely untrue. As for Councillor Lucy Hodgson, thank you very much, Councillor Hodgson, for your comments about Hannah. I think all our liaison engineers are doing a tremendous job, and it's nice to have that put on record. So thank you very much.
Thank you. And I've got two more hands up, I presume, for the same section. That's Mrs. Eyre and then Mr. Miller. Mrs. Eyre.
Thank you, Chairman. I don't think commenting on communication with members and general public would be good if I didn't mention how many letters and thanks I get for Barry Barnes from South Worcestershire and all he does for the residents there. Parish councils and residents write to me all the time for all he's doing. I just wanted to mention that I think you're the best cabinet member we've had in all my time in the council, because you listen. You don't always do everything I need, but you listen. And a quick question from the public. Through my channel content, I'm able to reach about 7,000 people every day. And one thing they've noticed is the street works information about road closures, etc. It's now stopped having the detailed information about how long the works will be. It says what the legal order is. So the legal order may be 2 weeks. But it used to say legal order 2 weeks, actual work 5 days. That's been dropped and they're finding it less helpful. Could you do something about that?
And Mr. Miller, please.
Thank you, Chairman. A question for the member responsible for highways. Yes, the liaison engineer, thank you. That has worked out very well. And the amount of compliments I get from the parish councils the work that he does is truly commendable. The one question I have had asked from parish councils is, I know we do give information and training at times, but parish councils have asked for specific training on how to understand highways problems and ask highways questions in relation to planning. And if a training session in the future could be arranged for parish councils on how they respond to highways planning issues, that would be appreciated by parish councils and town councils, I'm sure. That's another question, but it's on another section a bit later on. So thank you for that.
Mr. Amos.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Councillor Eyre, thank you very much. That's very kind of you. I should always remember that comment, so thank you very much indeed. And also thank you for your comments about Barry Barnes. He is a tremendous liaison officer, and as indeed they all are. On the question of street works information, obviously we always want to provide as much information as we can. Sometimes there's a little bit of a problem, certainly in the last year with the pandemic and people having to self-isolate, of being too precise about how long things will take, simply because we don't know. So rather than give wrong information, we sometimes decide to give no information. But actually, Caltra, it's a very valid point you make, and I will indeed take that with officers and look into doing that if it's at all possible, because I think it's exactly what people want to know. If something's going to happen outside their house, okay, fine, it's got to be done. How long is it going to take? And that's what they need to know. So absolutely right. Councillor Miller, thank you for that. Yes, very good point about parish linksmen training. We are very keen on that because they have responsibilities. We don't employ them, but they do have very important responsibilities, and we all strongly support that scheme. So yes, I will certainly take that up. I think a training session is always useful because things are constantly changing in the world of highways. And on planning, where I know there are most of them are controversial. So the more information we can give or guidance and help we can give to the parish linksmen, I say we don't employ them, but we will happily look into that, Councillor Miller, and hopefully get something off the ground by way of a training session, as you suggest.
Thank you, Mr. Amos. I'm seeing no more hands for that one. So we'll move on to the next section, pavement maintenance, paragraphs 18 and 20 to 20. And Mr. Clayton, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just wanted to say that my highway engineer in Redditch, Richard Clure, is absolutely brilliant, but I've just gone to my question. Can the cabinet member confirm the council is increasing for next year the highways members fund? Because I recently used some of my funding to replace some old block paving in Cardy Close in Batley, which is causing problems in my division. And if elected, I'd like to carry on that. So I just need to confirm this, please.
Thank you. And a question from Mr. Kent, please.
Thank you, Chair. I just wanted to say I'm absolutely delighted to see more money in footways, but what the cabinet member can do about the situation that when you do one, everybody else wants more. So I don't know what we do really with this. It just makes such an immediate impact on the residents. And unfortunately, I was only able to do half a pavement in one particular area with all the funds that I had available to extend it for the good people of Whittle in Douglas Road. But I'm delighted to see that we've managed to get the other half on the programme, which is obviously alleviated the concern, because I think sometimes when we do them, we end up with more complaints because everybody else wants theirs done. But thank you so much for the additional money, and thank you so much for the fact that we're going to get this Douglas Road actually completed. But I just, as I said, I think you've always got to deal with this more.
Thank you. And if I just take a third question from Mrs. Eyre, please, and then...
Thank you very much. It's just, I want to bring to your attention somewhere, it's not a highway and it's not a footway. The gravel's in Broadway. Broadway has to be different, doesn't it? It's a £100,000 plus job to redo the gravels. If you remember, they were last done after the 27th of March 1990 public inquiry. The gravels need redoing. It was an election pledge 4 years ago. I knew that it had to, it required a grant bid to government to get 100,000 plus for the gravels in Broadway. And I'm just wondering if you could, they still haven't been done. It is a hard amount of money to raise for a village like Broadway, but if you could raise that money and put somebody back onto trying to get us those funds, I'd be very grateful.
Thank you. Mr. Amos, please.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Councillor Clayton, absolutely. The answer, Brandon, is yes. As you know, in the last 2 years, we've found extra money so that each member could spend £43,000 over 2 years on the scheme of their choice in their division. And all members, I understand, have taken that up with alacrity. It was indeed so successful, and I say it's a question of empowering members to be the decision makers in their own division, that we have extended this for another year. So about 22,000 each member will have to spend on a highways project in their division of their choosing. So the answer to that one is yes. Councillor Kent, only Councillor Kent could ask a cheeky question with a smile on his face. And he wants more. Well, absolutely, Councillor Kent, I couldn't agree with you. This budget is about more and more and more. People very much value pavement, certainly the elderly. We all want to go out and walk. In fact, walking is the most common form of travel. So we want our pavements in tip-top condition. We want them to be in the top quartile. And indeed, we've got an excellent record on this. So absolutely, an extra £4 million last year on top, an extra £4 million next year on top. And the kilometres we're doing, we're clocking those up, 70 extra kilometres this year, 85 extra kilometres next year. It really is a tremendous record of success. So I totally agree with Councillor Kent, more and more, and that is our policy. Councillor Eyre is a special lady. Broadway is a special place. The gravels are special, but I can give this commitment. I'll certainly ask officers to look into this and see how we can progress it. I do accept it needs to be done, and we'll do our utmost to see if we can get this completed before too much longer. So I thank Councillor Eyre for that. And again, the answer is yes, as far as possible.
Thank you, Mr. Amos. And can I just remind everyone to keep their questions as short as possible, please, because we're already halfway through the allocated time and I'm seeing two more hands, Mr. Morris and then Mrs. Potter.
Thank you, Chairman. I too would like to thank Alan as Cabinet Member and the Highways Engineer Barry Barnes for the fantastic work they do. However, I have two large estates called Westlands and Chawson in my area, and they are walkway estates. They depend totally on the pathways. And I know there's been great support in giving a priority list of pavements for Westlands, which I appreciate. But if there's any possibility of targeting funds more to these estates that are heavily reliant on walking, where people have no other option, and the kids play on them, the mothers push the chairs, those that need support in walking have to navigate, then I would really welcome it.
Mrs. Potter.
Yes, thank you. I'd like to congratulate the Cabinet member and the Highways team for their innovative help in solving a problem in my division, which has been ongoing for more than 30 years. It's something I think that actually you'll all be quite familiar with, and that's speeding. We've installed a chicane-like system of poles along the Droitwich Road, which has gone a long way to reducing the speeds along that road. It's the first time the system has been used in Worcestershire, and it needs to be evaluated, but it certainly helped improve the lives of my residents. And I hope that the Cabinet member can confirm that this will be considered in time for other areas.
Thank you, Ms. Famous.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Councillor Morris. Yes, thank you, Councillor Morris. I totally agree with you. I visited the Westlands estate and seen that it is very much a place where people walk around. They need to walk. Mums with trams, disabled people and all the rest of it. It is absolutely essential that these pavements are safe and of good quality and condition. I totally take his point about walking, and we all need to do more of that, including me. I can fully commit that I will give always top priority to these kinds of schemes. I do want more money for pavements. I do want people to do more walking. I want it to be safe. So with all those conditions, the answer is a most definite yes. I will always fight for more resources for pavements, no ifs and buts. Councillor Potter, thank you very much, Councillor Potter, for your kind comments. Speeding, you're absolutely right. And I think what you, Councillor Potter, has done, Mr. Chairman, is shown the innovative way we can deal with speeding in the absence of any enforcement from the police. Chicanes are very, very effective. I know they were effective in some parts of Worcester. And yes, will we consider for other areas? Absolutely. We will consider any engineering means we can to reduce speeding, because I know speeding is a big problem in urban and rural areas, and we'll be as imaginative as we can be.
Thank you, Ms. Famous. I see no more questions for that section, so we can move on to paragraphs 21 to 26, highway maintenance, please. And Mr. Hopkins, you have a question?
Thank you very much, Chairman. Good afternoon, Council. And can I just echo the comments made, thanking both Alan for all that you do, and also Barry Barnes, who is an excellent officer, as everyone has said, and goes well above and beyond what is required on a regular basis. There's some really good work being done around my patch lately on roads and pavements. But two areas that remain a concern are the safety on the A422, which I know a study has been ongoing to look at how that can be improved. A lot of accidents have taken place there, including fatalities, and it's a big cause of concern. So anything more we can do to push that would be very well received. And the second one, which is probably a bit more tricky, but as it mentions issues from recent weather in this section, the erosion to road edges that have been caused by several bad winters in a row is getting to be quite a problem in our area. And it's a difficult one to fix, of course, because you can't just patch road edges and often they wash away again. But anything more that could be done to look at erosion to road edges, particularly around Inkburn and the Lenches, really appreciate that. But thank you for all you do, Alan.
Thank you, Mr. Amos.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Can I thank Councillor Hopkins for his very kind comments? That's very kind, and certainly I'll pass them on again to Barry Barnes. The A422 safety issues, I am aware of those. And I think in the light of what Councillor Hopkins has said, I'll ask officers to have a particular look at that to see whether we can undertake some more engineering solutions to that. It's not easy because we have looked at it before. But certainly I will, and on the other question of the edging and the erosion, I will ask our head of highways operations to have a look at that, because I suspect it's a problem not just in his area, but other areas as well. And it is something we want to keep on top of, because we always take the view that if we can prevent things from happening, it's better than having to deal with them after they've happened. So again, Thanks. That's a very constructive issue. So thank you, Councillor Hopkins, for raising that. And I'll get the head of Highways Operations to look into it in not only your division, but others as well.
Thank you, Mr. Famous. And I have a hand up for Mr. Miller, please.
Yes, thank you, Chairman. And again, thank you very much for the quality of work that is undertaken by our maintenance people in patching up the roads and making them safe. But the single track roads that are a lot of them in my area, again, when we have a planning decision for that single track road to become an entrance to an industrial estate, as such as in Lower Town, then that single track road is absolutely churned up by heavy goods wagons, 38 and 42 ton wagons on a single track road that was never designed for that weight of vehicle. There must be some method that we can use to limit the heavy weight of these vehicles, because we're patching up and repairing and then they're getting damaged. And it's like a treadmill. So we need some sort of relook at our policy with single track roads and heavy goods vehicles, I believe. Thank you, Chairman.
Thank you. And I'll also see a hand up for Dr. Hotham, please.
Thank you, Chairman. Good afternoon, Council. I too would like to echo my thanks to Councillor Amos, because I personally believe the roads in Worcestershire are in an excellent state compared to neighbouring authorities. I too cycle around quite a bit, not on an electric bike, Adam, on a human-powered bike, but as you live next to Carpenter's Hill, I maybe forgive you. My question is looking at highways maintenance, it's great we're spending all this money, but looking on page 33, when we're issuing penalty notices, it appears that Worcestershire highways are receiving virtually double the number of penalty notices that other contractors are receiving. And I wonder if Councillor Amos could comment on that and assure me that we're not actually wasting money by having to revisit botched jobs. Thank you.
Thank you. Councillor Amos, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Councillor Miller, yes, thank you for those comments, Councillor Miller, and in terms of the quality of the work. And I think a lot of that is due to the work that we do with Ringway, our contractor, with whom we have very good relationship. And I think also a pretty rigorous inspection regime as well, because it's not, you know, if things go wrong, we want to put it right pretty quickly. So thank you for that. Interesting question, Tony, on this one, single track and heavy vehicles usage thereof. If he could just email me the details of the particular case he has in mind, we can look at that, because that may well inform us about wider issues. Without having specific cases, it's difficult to know what to do. So if Tony, you could email me just the barest details on that, I would be most grateful, and I will certainly look at that. Councillor Hotham, thank you, Charlie. That's a very, very neat effort to get onto paragraph 33 while we're on paragraph 21. So perhaps I could save my comments on for that. But certainly, I don't think it is the case at all that we do botched work. I'm very hot on the quality of the work we do. This is why we are aiming to be in the top quartile for the condition of our roads and pavements, because that is the true test of the quality of the work that we do. We want to be in the top 25%, and we're nearly there. We have a pretty robust regime for example, dealing with potholes and other road repairs on a one-day, 1 week, 1 month basis. And we have 16 inspectors who go round and look at that on a regular basis. So I'm not quite sure. It's a bit of a general point there, Charlie, on botched work. But all I can say is, if we find we've done something wrong, our policy is we apologise and put it right, move on. We don't no ifs and buts.
Thank you very much, Mr. Amos. Thank you for that. And I'm afraid we've run out of time on this item. So I'll need to move us on to the next section, agenda item 7, please. Notices of motion. Please turn to pages 45 and 46. Three valid notices of motion have been received by the Assistant Director for Legal and Governance. Members are reminded that a maximum of 90 minutes will be set aside for all discussions on notices of motion, and I'll therefore ask any points made are brief and concise, please. I would also ask if any member is speaking on behalf of their group leader that they do indicate that before they speak, so the appropriate time can be allocated to their speech. It does help if you can just do that, please. So the first notice of motion, superfast broadband. And I'm obviously going to invite the signatories to move and second this motion. And I think that's Mr. Kent and Mr. O'Donnell. So Mr. Kent, please.
Thank you, Chair, and good afternoon, Council. Rarely does any business, individual or council, have the foresight to implement policy that can have such a material impact on so many residents and businesses. Who would have believed back in 2011, 6 years before I joined the council, how important superfast broadband would have been to the residents and businesses of Worcestershire? Back in 2013, only 69% of our residents and 41% of businesses had access to a superfast broadband connection. That would have meant that during this current pandemic, 3 out of 10 of the residents would have not had an effective broadband connection, and 6 out of 10 businesses would have not been able to function in this new remote world. Our current figures show 97.3% of residents in Worcestershire have access to superfast broadband, and the increase in access for businesses has gone from 41% to an amazing 90%, more than doubled. I understand that when this investment was announced, there were many detractors, and one would ask, where are those detractors now? I remember prior to that investment in my own home having a dial-up line with a 56K board modem and having to purchase an expensive satellite connection to be able to work from home. I could afford it, though many couldn't. As a county councillor, I brought a motion to council on a similar topic, imploring the county councillors to get involved locally with residents and businesses so that we could get our numbers even higher and benefit even more residents. This has been achieved with many councillors getting involved, and I thank you all for that. But even more so, I thank the team of Robert, Steve and Ian for the sterling work they've done in driving this investment forward. I've been absolutely delighted to have been personally involved in 7 separate schemes in Whithall. I remember one of my first meetings in a packed out coach and horses, and I am looking forward to getting back there, where we recruited multiple project leads from local residents. And this has led to those 7 schemes providing life-changing broadband access to over 300 properties in Whithall and the surrounding area, who now benefit from superfast broadband, where before many were struggling with appalling download speeds. Many of those 300 homes with over 500 residents would have been unable to work from home in the current pandemic. The impact on business has been phenomenal. And my understanding from the team is that we were one of the only authorities, if not the only authority, to implement clear business targets. And that is evidenced with the success shown in the figures I've quoted. Again, an increase in business coverage from 41% to 90%, doubled. Our residential figure at 97.3%, surely then we've met our goal and that's it, project complete. I say no. Our ambition may well be taking businesses and residential to 100%, but I say this should just be the start of our ambition. Changes to the qualifying criteria last year now mean that instead of having to have a connection speed below 24 meg to qualify for a service upgrade, one can qualify for an upgrade if your current speed is below 100 meg. And I can remember when the target for homes was 2. The government have financed an incredibly generous scheme that, while somewhat difficult to implement, has meant that Worcestershire alone has completed over 220 projects. Our ambition, however, clearly should be for every home in Worcestershire to have a gigabit connection. We won't be able to do this on our own. We will need government support. And therefore, this motion asks that council recognises that superfast broadband has become far more than an aspiration and has, following recent events, become extremely important for the residents in Worcestershire, but particularly bearing in mind the needs of those involved in homeschooling and remote working. Recently, as explained, the qualifying speed has increased to 100 meg, opening up even more areas that qualify to receive broadband vouchers to support the cost of gigabit fibre to the premise connections. Council therefore requests that the Cabinet Member responsible brings a report to Council detailing the progress to date and sets out our future goals and aspirations. This Council showed incredible foresight 10 years ago to make this investment on behalf of our residents and businesses. Let's together ensure Worcestershire continues to lead and let others follow, Please support this motion unanimously. It is vital to the future success of our county.
Thank you, Mr. Kent. Mr. O'Donnell, please.
Thank you, Chair. This is a matter that touches all of our residents in all of our divisions. I can only support what Councillor Kent said. I'm sure I'm not the only one that if you'd have said to me a year ago I would spend most of my time sat in front of a computer on video meetings, I'd have been surprised. The list in the ways that the foresight and investment in this has improved our ability to deal over the last year is incalculable. The rapid adoption of technology, the improvement in standards, both not accepting the lower speeds and the striving for continual improvement in technology has meant that we're not looking backwards, as Councillor Kent said, we're looking forwards. Homeschooling, home teaching, remote doctor's appointments, staying in contact with family and friends during this last year of this pandemic cannot be underestimated in the impact that it's had. Quiz nights, online quiz nights are not something I'd have ever thought we'd have all taken part in a year ago. This council meeting, the ability for residents to be involved in the democratic process more easily than ever before. All of these things have now become parts of our normal lives and probably will be for some time to come. Moving forward, the impacts of this technology on our ability to cope during the pandemic and after the pandemic at some point in the future is key to our economic recovery and economic survival. Diversifying our businesses and seeing the local economy move.
Have we lost contact there? Ah, you're back. No?
Broadband's down.
Yeah, I lost
a bit of connection there, sorry, Chair.
Yeah, we lost you just the last few moments. Oh,
yeah. So I'm more than happy to second this this motion. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Council, is this to be dealt with today, please? Yeah, I think we're agreed on that one. So we'll move on then to debate this one. I see several hands up, but I think Mrs. Zaborski and Mr. Denham, I think your hands are up from the previous item. Do you intend to have them up now? Okay. So in that case, Mrs. Zaborski then, please.
Yeah, I'm delighted to support this motion. I've got an anomalous situation about 300 yards from where I live, where one connection box on the whole estate has not been upgraded, and residents in about the sort of 50 houses that it feeds have very slow internet connections, whereas the rest of the estate has very fast. And it really is difficult for students who live there who can't manage their online work, and from a couple of people who are running businesses from home. If somebody said to us at the beginning of 2020 that we would be spending so much time on internet meetings, we would all have laughed at them. But in fact, we would not be able to operate as a council if we weren't able to use decent internet connections. I think it's incredibly important that everybody has that opportunity, because we have young people missing out on schooling just because they can't get fast enough broadband connections. This is terribly important, and it's something we should be lobbying government and everybody really hard on.
Thank you. And then if I have Mr. Denham and then Mrs. Hodgson. Mr. Denham, please.
Thank you, Chair. Yes, I'm responding on behalf of the Labour Group, and you'll be no doubt pleased to hear the proposals that our group will be supporting this motion. But I just wanted to point out some of the issues that that we have, and that is that it's all very well providing high-speed broadband, welcome as it is and useful as it is. But there are large numbers of families in this county who simply, large number of households, who simply cannot afford even low-speed broadband and simply haven't got the necessary equipment to make use of broadband. I'm aware of one high school in my own that is attended by many children within my own division, where hundreds, literally hundreds of children have not got the ability to connect to the internet because of inadequate equipment or inadequate connections. And that's despite the government having provided pieces of equipment for pupils in that school. There are still hundreds of children there unable to learn at home. And that's, of course, on top of the problems they have when they're competing with a low-speed internet connection with brothers and sisters who are also trying to home learn, and also with parents who are working from home. So whilst this is all very welcome and we support it, please don't forget the ones who are at the other end of the scale, that the many, many people living in deprived families, which I'm very familiar with, who simply can't afford broadband at all and haven't got the equipment to be able to access it. Thank you.
Thank you. And now I'll call on Mrs. Hodgson and then Mr. Morris. Mrs. Hodgson.
Thank you for that. I remember, well, it must have been 10, 12 years ago when we were first approached about problem issues of broadband speed. I happened to be in Warnden Villages, where I'm a district councillor and where I live. And there were real concerns over black spots, particularly around the industrial estate where Bosch is and other areas. And by getting involved, it was with BT at the time, we were able to, through the council, we were able to persuade, I think it was Councillor Pollock, to look at doing some scrutiny exercises around broadband provision. And I just think from where we've come from and where we are now, we've come absolutely miles. Yes, there are still people out there that have got poor provision, and there are many good schemes out there. Today, I'm upstairs in my office using one computer. My husband is working downstairs, working from home, because it's not safe to go to Mulladares where he is. And we are not unique. There are many families. There has been some good work about provision of IT for schools, but there's also been some really good work within the council about IT provision for members as well as staff. And I was only hearing about the governance yesterday. So I commend the work that has been done. Completely understand that there is more to be done, but we have done really, really well. Yet again, Worcestershire has done better than many areas.
Thank you. And now I have Mr. Morris and then Dr. Pollock. Mr. Morris, please.
Thank you, Chairman, and I'm pleased to support this motion. And I commend Councillor Kent on the initiatives he's taken in Withill to do with broadband too. And that shows the leadership that we as members do need to take. We can be a solution to a large part of any issues that exist. And you only have to look at .gov UK for guidance on community-led broadband options. Yeah, and you can develop a broadband project which falls into check requirement, agree approach and local action. And through that, to support Councillor Denham as well, you can even look to the funding options as well. You've got a postcode checker to see what your broadband is, and then the rural gigabit broadband vouchers are available for businesses and residents depending on their need. So I would urge members to seek support from officers, obviously, who are doing a sterling job, but also to look at .gov.uk for community-led projects on broadband. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Morris. And Dr. Pollock, please. And I think you're responding on behalf of the Conservative group.
Mr. Chairman, thank you very much. I'm very pleased to be able to say that is true. I've noticed a certain amount of interruption to the contributions made this afternoon, and I hope this won't happen too much with me, because I've been aware of that's happened to some other people. Let me just say that I really am very grateful for this motion. I welcome it very much on behalf of the Conservative group and the Cabinet in particular. This is an area of real achievement for the County Council. And just to go directly to what the motion is talking about, I will ensure that a full report is brought to Council in the near future, because we've got a very good team doing this, and I'm sure we've got a very good story to tell. So just one or two things to say. A lot of the points have already been made, so please forgive me if this is a bit duplication, because we've had some very effective contributions already from the emotion people. This refers to the rural gigabit connectivity programme with the lower limit raised to 100 megabits per second. let's be absolutely clear about these numbers. It used to be that people were getting about 1 megabit per second. In this year, the government said anybody getting less than 10 would have the right to ask for more. We're used to the term superfast broadband. That meant 24 megabits per second. Pretty good, you'd have thought. The European Union said, no, make it 30. We're now saying anybody less than 100 can apply for more help because they want to get to the gigabit thing, and that is 1,000, 1 gigabit. So there's a great deal of progression from there. And there are various ways of doing this. There's the gap-funded projects, there's the gigabit vouchers, and there are obviously also commercial developments. And let's be aware that when this started, when we started on this route, there was widespread opposition. Widespread opposition partly because there were commercial companies involved. And it was thought this was a way in which we were going to help BT, etc., make bigger profits. Well, let's put that to one side, because the important thing that we got in early, about 2012, to start promoting this superfast broadband, and it was, my name was mentioned earlier, I think in fact it was probably Simon Geraghty, our leader, who was the progenitor of this and the real mover. And let me make one last small point here. Worcestershire is unusual, if not still unique, in saying that we are not only interested in helping residences, we are also keen to help businesses. And most people have thought residence is the important thing. If you read about this in the press, it's generally just residence homes. Obviously, families need this kind of thing. But on the other hand, we have always said, Simon Geraghty said at the beginning, and it's still true, we must help business as well. And you've heard already, this is now more or less essential, is it not? For help from working from home, how could we hold this meeting without? Homeschooling's been mentioned several times, absolutely crucial. I have two daughters I can't see, but we do have family connections by Zoom, makes a big difference. There's entertainment, obviously, and also the whole question of staying safe. So we've had huge achievements since the start in 2013. Something like 80,000 premises have been connected. And I won't go through all the numbers, I've got a long list here, but it's really not very helpful, I suppose. But for businesses, it's now over 90%, you heard, over superfast broadband, 24 megabits per second, 97.2%. Any sort of fibre, 99.5%, and gigabit capable now is up to 37.3%. We have spent £2.7 million on 3,000 premises in the last 18 months. Residential could get a grant of £1,500, businesses £3,500. We've committed another £3 million for this, and we are in the top 5 out of 100 local authorities. It's a really good story for the county council. And under the new scheme, we've committed another £1 million, and that'll mean we can double for the amount for a residence to £3,000 and a business to £7,000, because there've been lots of communities where the whole process has stalled because there's not enough people, not enough money. So now we can double that amount, and that will, with any luck, help a great deal. Because BDUK has got about £5 billion to spend on making the country gigabit capable by 2025. So we want some of that money for ourselves. Of course, there will be places where this doesn't really work. Councillor Dennis mentioned some of the difficulties. We do recognize that, but we are fully committed to it. We completely endorse this whole idea. We want to work with the commercial operations like Airband. Airband, after all, started off at the very beginning. We had 14 rural communities in place before we started this project with Airband, based in Worcester, doing very well. Plus City Fibre, BT Openreach, Virgin Media, all sorts of places. So we're working towards trying to get that final 20% who maybe don't have the proper connections yet. So let me just finish. There's nothing else to say. This is a really important motion. I'm very pleased to hear that other people are going to support it. I'd like to have my thanks to Simon Geraghty, who was the political mover and the progenitor of this. I've just been carried along on the wave. And their officers you've mentioned already, Steve Ashton, Rob Stefanski. Absolutely brilliant. The feedback I get from my parish councils for those guys is very, very positive. I bet every officer in the county employ would like to be as well regarded as those guys. So first class, and I urge you all to support this motion. Thank you.
Thank you. And our next speaker is Dr. Hopkins and then Mr. Clayton. Dr. Hopkins, please.
Thank you, Chairman. And I just wanted to associate myself with much of what's already been said, and thank Adam for bringing this motion forward, which I'm very happy to put my name to and support. I think when I started in this role 4 years ago, many places in my division really struggled with the internet, particularly in the Lenches and on the edge of several of the large villages even. There were people getting 1 or 2 megabits per second if they were lucky. They used to tell me it wasn't much above dial-up. It's still not perfect. There are 1 or 2 outliers and more remote places, patches that haven't got it as good as we would like yet. But many places, particularly those villages like Abbots Morton that have got super fast broadband in the last couple of years, are so grateful that they have got it, given all that others have said about the situations we're all finding ourselves in, sat in front of computer screens right now. I think just want to finish by echoing all of those comments made about the officers. I sit in parish council meetings so often where the superfast Worcestershire team is praised, and you don't hear any criticism of them at all. They're really top notch. So just to echo that, and thank you all.
Thank you. And next we have Mr. Clayton and then Mr. Miller. Mr. Clayton, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I, for one, would like to thank the Conservative administration on behalf of the residents of Redditch for the foresight over many years and for taking no notice of the opposition of people who did not agree in the beginning and did not want us to allocate funds available in the budget process each year, on providing the residents of Worcestershire with superfast broadband, especially in the rural areas of the county, but also in the towns and villages. I can tell members, after talking to residents in Redditch North, of how much they appreciate this service, especially during this COVID period we are in at the moment. This is something we should all be very proud of, and I will support this motion.
Thank you. And now we have Mr. Miller and then Ms. Webb. Mr. Miller.
Thank you, Chairman. I too would like to support this motion, and I have some good reasons to do so. Improvement in how we look after our people in care at home. Technology has progressed so much that we can monitor and make sure those people in a vulnerable situation are cared for. And to do this, what do they need? Good broadband connection. So that is one very good reason for going ahead and getting this super fast broadband, not to 98, but to 100%, if that is at all possible. But the one plea I do have is for our farming and our agricultural community. Farming and agriculture has changed, and technology and innovation has certainly changed this in a very big way. For our farmers, they need to keep an audit trail of their livestock, and that all needs to be referenced so the farmer can operate their milk yield and all the produce that they grow in their fields. We are looking at helping those farmers reduce the amount of insecticides they use so that insecticide doesn't fall into our watercourses, because we don't want the insecticides in our watercourses. We want clean water, of course. So how do they monitor that? They monitor that by using technology. How can they tell what it is? By outside companies giving them analysis of their soil quality and what is in the soil. And this can all be done but with the use of superfast broadband. So put a plea in for our farmers that those in the outlying areas that will be relying on superfast broadband and all the help we can give those, that industry, it is one of the largest industries in Worcestershire after all. So let us try and help those industries. And when we come to try and help them, maybe we will have a unanimous decision from all councillors that we actually achieve this, and not those councillors who look at it and say we're doing the wrong thing. Because at the end of the day, the Conservative administration did the right thing at the time, and the proof is in the eating, and we are most certainly having a good meal on it. Thank you, Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Miller. Okay, and I now go to Ms. Webb, followed by Mr. Jenkins. Ms. Webb.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm fully supportive of this motion, and I would like to thank our own officers, Rob, Steph Hosky, and Steve Ashton in particular, were both excellent in their communications and attending our residents and parish council meetings. Thank you also to Councillor Kent and Councillor May, who are helping me establish some community schemes in my own division. We are all really keen to ensure all residents and businesses in our divisions are able to access fibre. Thank you.
Thank you. And now Mr. Jenkins, please, followed by Mrs. Tucker. Mr. Jenkins.
Thank you, Chair. I'd say there's certainly been cross-party support for this, and I think all in our group support as well. So I'd hope fairly soon, if not maybe after Liz has spoken, we could maybe move to a vote as soon as possible, as we've got a couple more motions to go. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Jenkins. Mrs. Tucker and then Ms. May, please. You're on mute, Mrs. Tucker.
Right. Sorry about that. And I will be quick. Yes, I support the motion, but can the report also be able to pick up the issue of the problem with individual properties and patches inside the areas that are already got good broadband? I mean, we all sit in meetings and see things go still or silent or gets mumbled up so you can't hear what's going on. And I do think that's something that should have attention paid to it. Also, is the council lobbying for continued ability to hold up meetings online if we so wish? Because Robert Jenrick was saying that there was nothing planned for the necessary legislation, and the current legislation runs out in May. Thank you.
Thank you. And now Ms. May and then Mr. Hart, please. Ms. May.
Thank you very much, Chairman, and thank you to Councillor Kent for bringing forward this motion. Absolutely in support of this. Never has broadband connectivity, as we all know, been so important to our residents. In my own county division, 106 homes have had additional broadband in Balbroughton, 250 in Hagley, 177 in Romsley, and I've still got a further 200 homes that are looking for that connectivity. In addition to what Councillor Miller said, I think we could also say that it's the requirement to pay your VAT returns online in the rural communities as well. So it's even more important that they get great connectivity so they can feed in, get the VAT returns done and do their administration. I feel quite strongly about this. Living in a home currently that has struggled because of the age of the property, 400 years old, that we don't get great connectivity. So for all of us in this county, it's most important. We're asking people to get in touch with us online. We need to make sure that we have full connectivity. As one of the other councillors said, 100% is our goal, and I'm sure we'll get there with this administration. Many thanks.
Thank you. And Mr. Hart and then Mr. McKay, please.
Thank you, Chairman. I should try and be brief and not repeat comments that have already been made. But just in respect to what Councillor Denham said about the number of pupils in terms of not being able to connect or not having a laptop, of course, not directly related to this motion in terms of laptop numbers. But I did feel that it was important to say that we absolutely appreciate from an education perspective the need for connectivity. I know that Worcestershire Children's First have allocated over 1,000 laptops to vulnerable learners to ensure that our most vulnerable children do have access to education and online education. Importantly, that's why the government extended this the criterion category of vulnerable learners, so that those who didn't have access to laptops, but also the connectivity issues, were able to go into school. And just from the perspective of broadband and how fantastic it is, and I live in a rural location, and I guess sometimes we have to expect some of you might be delighted that I sometimes lose connection. Of course, you know, that's one of the things of life, isn't it? When we're all in a pre-COVID world, coming and going to meetings, sometimes we got stuff in traffic. Sometimes there was a road accident and we could never get there at all. So, you know, we do have to have some flexibility, and we know that there will be these little quirks, but it is transformed our lives. I've no doubt that if we are still obviously in a position where we can't safe distance, the government will legislate for post-May meetings, whether it be primary or secondary legislation. It will certainly make its way into being. But I look forward to a world where not necessarily formal meetings like this, because one misses the theatre of council, but look forward to a a hybrid approach where more briefings could take place over the virtual platform. Councillor Kent made a very good point earlier about the cost in man hours and in terms of mileage expenses that it saves. So let's rejoice not only in our political lives, but for our residents, school children and businesses, a hybrid approach so that we have a greater Worcestershire ahead.
Thank you, Mr. Hart. In fact, I've only got two hands still up, and I think after those, it's time to move to summing up. So I'm going to ask Mr. McKay to speak, and then Mr. Rogers. Mr. McKay.
Thank you, Chair. I will keep it brief. This motion talks of goals and aspirations as more and more families move to these increased bandwidths, so they see the benefits at home. You only have to see the multitude of appliances now available in homes to see the benefits of more speedy internet, allowing all who need it to be able to access whatever is necessary, rewarding at the same time, be it smart TV, gaming consoles, music streaming, mobile phones, towers, laptops, all require the right input. I think somebody has already mentioned today about being able to work while the husband was working downstairs as well. It's got to be the way forward. Above that, we look for online shopping, online banking, and obtaining that important document, passport or car tax, whichever we want. And we've all got it at our fingertips, or at least we all should have if we can get it countywide. And the demand will grow just as we've seen it expand with schools and businesses over recent times. So to have those faster speeds at those times of day when the net is so much in demand means businesses can keep up. Frustrations with buffering and slow downloads could be a thing of the past if the technology is available, as I say, across the county. Time wasted means productivity lessens. And in the economic climate which we're currently experiencing, that's something we really do need to try and avoid. So being able to have uninterrupted video conferencing and remote access to the workplace is the advantage we have all seen as we conduct our business, even now. So, yeah, I absolutely promote this motion and will support it without hesitation. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you. And then I'll take Mr. Rogers as our last speaker and then ask Mr. Kent to sum up. Mr. Rogers.
Thank you, Chairman. I will be brief, and I'd like to thank Councillor Kent for bringing this motion. It is, as they say, a no-brainer. And another expression we learnt last year was the new normal. This is the new normal, and welcome, friends. By not driving all over the place and having our meetings online, we are doing what we've also been asked to, which is be green. We're not driving around, we're not wasting fuel, we're not wasting time. We're managing to conduct our business in a very, very friendly way to the planet. So that again is a bonus. What I would like to say, moreover, is that we describe ourselves as world-class Worcestershire. 100% gigabit coverage is a part of being world-class. Let's bring it on. Thank you, Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Rogers. And now I'll ask Mr. Kent to sum up for us, please. And then we go to the vote.
Thank you very much, Chair, and thank you very much, Council. Some very important and salient points in there, and I'd like to pick up on a couple of them, perhaps starting with Councillor Denham's point, which was well made and understood, and I'd like to thank Councillor Hart for answering it for me. But I think we do have to respect that we have to provide the means for all to be able to access broadband and to be able to use the services in the way that we're moving forward. I think Councillor Hodgson made a great point about multiple users. It's not like we're just alone at home. The situation is my partner's working upstairs. There's other families that are then doing homeschooling. So these types of speeds are becoming absolutely critical and essential to be able to support all of those concurrent users. Heaven forbid I'd got a couple of kids at home that started to download something on Netflix at the same time. And this is the problems that we're facing. I think Councillor Morris raised another very valid point. It's down to us, the members, to be able to identify those in our area that have got insufficient broadband, even though they might not know themselves. And that's where the team at Worcestershire County Council has worked really hard. You can look at a map, you see the red dots, which I think are 24 meg at the moment. They're being upgraded to whatever colour they are for under 100. But that really does raise a flag to you, to that area in your locality needs some looking at. And if you're not sure how to do it, I'm sure if you reach out to that team, they'll be more than willing to assist you and take you along in the right way. Councillor Pollock raised a myriad of good points, really, in terms of what we're trying to do and what was a normal speed, talking about when we were at 1 megabyte and now our ambition is 100, when in reality it's 1,000. And who's to say it won't stop after that? But if we can get the infrastructure in place with the investment we're doing, then anything's going to be possible. The amount of money spent is remarkable. And I suppose you do have to thank the government to a certain extent for this broadband voucher scheme. And for those of you that don't really understand how it works, if there's 20 homes that haven't got the speed, effectively we get a quote that says it's going to cost this much to give them to fibre to the premise, and those broadband vouchers that we're doubling up go towards that cost. So if the cost is met by the vouchers that are provided, it's no extra cost to the residents. And the broadband connections that they receive should not cost them any more than their current broadband connection. I've knocked on doors before COVID and dropped letters in, and you get the skepticism that's saying, well, what's the catch? No, it's free. No, well, it can't be. But it is, you know, just fill the form out. And most of our time is spent chasing the forms. So I do understand those that have got some criticism of the current system, but it is working. Councillor Hopkins, still more to be done. Those last 3% are the most important. They're the people that haven't got it. And the 97% now are the privileged and the 3% are the few. And we do have to deal with those. And I'm sure that we will. Councillor Clayton covers the foresight. Well, that's always a sign of good management, isn't it? Seeing what's going to come in the future. I don't think we saw this. I think we just saw the advantages to Worcestershire. And the productivity improvements it's going to make moving on, which I will refer to, are vast. Councillor Miller, some very interesting observations as ever about farmers and farms and monitoring and all sorts of different systems that are being utilised. It's even security cameras. I hope we can use it to catch some fly tippers in the future. That would certainly be welcome. And thank you, Shirley, for your comments. More than happy to help. Councillor Jenkins, we're on the way to the vote, but as a Green campaigner, I'm sure you're absolutely delighted that we haven't travelled to the meeting today and the money that we've saved and the lack of diesel fumes that have been put into the air. Councillor Tucker raises the issue of those individual properties, and I would urge you to perhaps work with the team and just see if they come up with the red dot, just see what the situation is. It might be a local problem that they might have a faulty telephone socket that's got water in it or poor Wi-Fi or whatever else. But if you have a chat with the team, they can isolate that and show you on the map. Councillor May, yeah, broadband connectivity in large properties. I won't say any more about that, but it's absolutely critical for everybody all over the place, really. And it's vital that we improve it. And we do have to get to that 100%. And Councillor Hart bringing up the issue with pupils and the donation of the laptops. I suppose it's great to give the laptop, but we do have to make sure that we can ensure that they can do the broadband as well. One of the things I wanted to pick up on, really, and on all the other subjects, I think Councillor Rogers summed it up most at the end, really, with the fact that we're not driving to meetings. This is a really green and economical way. I respect the element that we're talking about from Councillor Hart in terms of the hybrid approach. And we've got to take it really carefully in terms of what we do, because I, for one, do not want to go back to 24 hours a week in the car traveling between Birmingham, Bromsgrove and Worcester. But it has to be a hybrid situation. I understand what you're saying, but other people are going to be vulnerable. So we do need to lobby moving forward. But thank you very much for the positive comments. I do hope we can get a unanimous vote. And let's all drive forward to make sure that Worcestershire is the place that others like to follow.
Thank you, Mr. Kent. Thank you. And I'll now hand over to Sheena for the vote. And obviously she'll be using the polling function in Zoom, which I think you've all seen and used before. Sheena, please.
Thank you, Chairman. I'm launching the poll now. I'll give you a half a minute to decide to vote for, against or abstain, please. I think probably everybody has finished polling. I'll end poll And that shows that 47 out of 47 have voted in favour, Chairman.
Thank you, sir. I think that's very clearly carried. Thank you. Thank you for that. And now we'll move on to the second notice of motion, bus franchising. And again, I will invite Mr. Denham to move and I think Mr. Lund to second. Mr. Denham, please.
Thank you, Chairman. Yes, I'm delighted to propose this, which will be the last motion I propose in this council because I'm not seeking re-election in May. But it's a motion which offers real hope for all for residents in all 57 divisions of our county. We all have isolated, vulnerable residents and some without access to private cars. For these people, the bus network is vital. But buses also contribute to the future success of our county, economically and in the fight against climate change. In short, buses are an essential area of public policy that have been ignored for too long. The 2017 Bus Services Act provides local transport authorities like Worcestershire County Council with the opportunity to put this right by applying to the Secretary of State for Transport to become a bus franchising authority. Ongoing reductions in local authority funding by central government over the last decade have gradually eroded our bus network and left a patchwork service in Worcestershire. To reverse this trend, we now need to see increased funding and greater coordination of bus services through the refranchising model in our county if we are to deliver a quality, comprehensive bus network. Franchising has been used in London for many years. What is good enough for London is good enough for Worcestershire. Introducing franchising would enable this county council to determine the details of the services to be provided, where they run, when they run, and the standards of the services. The Department for Transport has outlined how franchising can be a benefit to local areas by giving local government the power to decide what buses run where and when, the types of tickets available, including discounts for apprentices or other passengers as required, what types of payment must be accepted, including smart and contactless, what information is available to passengers. Putting responsibility for key local roads and deciding which bus services run in one place. Giving local government the power to decide what sorts of buses must be used, including their emission standards or technologies. Local government is accountable to local people. It would set all the fares. Giving local government central funding for bus services. Taking a more strategic view of what services are needed and where, and focusing services where they are most needed, rather than where the best commercial opportunity may be. Creating effective competition to run bus services in areas where there is little on-road competition today. Local government joining up their planning of local transport services across models and types of provision, including school and health transport. Allowing commercial bidders for franchises to innovate too. The 2017 Bus Services Act introduced a range of options for local government to improve bus services. One of these measures enables local authorities to request from the Secretary of State the right to introduce franchising. Whilst there is no guarantee that the Secretary of State will grant this power, it's important that we make the ask in order to show that there is strong support for greater bus coordination at local level. We all want to see Worcestershire flourish, and a world-class public transport system for our county is vital if we're to achieve our maximum potential. And we must not overlook the centrality of the bus to our communities and future economic success. We know that franchising is a better model than our present system. We don't see any campaigns to ditch the franchising model in London, for example. Rather, we want the best for the communities in our county. Now, therefore, I urge all members to commit this council to make the formal request to Grant Chaps MP, the Secretary of State of the Department of Transport, to introduce such a model in Worcestershire. I move. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you, Mr. Denham. And now ask Mr. Lund to second, please.
Thank you, Chair. In life, I always think it's appropriate to try something new and what is currently being used is not working in the intended way. It would take the most rose-tinted optimist to say that we have the ideal system for bus services and routes across the county, fragmented rather than franchised, I would argue. Therefore, it is important to fully explore ideas which work elsewhere and see if the same will be true across parts or all of our county. One of the key benefits of franchising is that it gives us a tier one local authority the power to decide what bus services run where and when. It also allows us to decide the types of tickets available, including reductions for students and apprenticeships, as well as how fares are connected. In short, Worcestershire solutions for Worcestershire challenges. It would also enable us to decide on the type of buses being used and their emissions. I would tentatively suggest that this would benefit the environment. A key part of all of this is better value for money and actually making us accountable to our electorates by setting the fares. We could do this by us receiving the central funding rather than it being given to the operators directly. At the moment, I would argue that we have the worst of every world, getting criticism for the quality of many services without having the power awarded to us to do what we might like to do to change the situation. We have an understanding of what needs to be done. Going back to where I started this morning, we need to take a more strategic view of what services are needed, where they are needed, and indeed what times of day they are needed. In the last 5 to 6 years, I've seen many examples of services being taken off, which could have been made to work if they had been promoted better by the bus company. We genuinely believe that bus franchising is the way forward in Worcestershire. We urge the Secretary of State to give us the option to put it into practice. But as the first step, we urge this council to call for the shackles to be taken off of us. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Mr. Lunn. And does council wish to deal with this today, please? I'll take that as a yes. Thank you. So now we can open the debate. And I'm seeing quite a few hands up here. So the first one is Mrs. Zaborski and then Mr. Jenkins. Mrs. Zaborski.
Thank you. Yes, I'm delighted to support this motion. We have a climate emergency. We know we should be encouraging residents and ourselves out of our cars. And for journeys that are too long for you to be walking, public transport is the obvious thing we should have. But we don't have a unified public transport system in this county. It's totally fragmented. All of us, even representing urban areas, have estates where you simply can't get a bus to and from work. In the area I represent, a lot of people are commuting. We have the beautiful new Kidderminster railway station, and once we're out of the lockdown, the car park is going to be jammed full to overcrowding. Because if you're going to be commuting from Kidderminster to Worcester or to Birmingham to work, you're going to be needing to catch a bus, a train, sorry, between probably 7 and 7:30 in the morning. But the buses aren't running at that time in the morning. So people are having to take their cars to the railway station, park them there for the day so that they can catch the train to and from work. This is absolutely ludicrous. We should be making sure that there are bus services available to take people to work and to get them back, to take them to the railway station and get them back. A lot of people in my division are shift workers. And at 5:30 in the morning, it is not particularly nice to have to walk through darkened streets, particularly if the streetlights have failed on alleyways, but there are no suitable buses. If you leave work in Kidderminster to get home, unless you can do a sprint from your place of work to the bus depot, soon after 6 o'clock, there will not be a bus to get you home, unless you're one of the lucky people who needs to travel between Kidderminster and Stourport, which is the only decent bus service in the whole of Wyre Forest. It's really important if we want people to be out of their cars, we want a more green transport policy, we need the ability to have much more power to direct where buses will run. And I think this motion is the way forward. We might very well not get permission from the Secretary of State for Transport, but you certainly won't get permission from him if you don't even bother to ask him. And that's why I think this motion is a good idea.
Thank you for that. Can I just ask all members to try and keep their comments brief and to the point, because it'd be nice if we could actually deal with the third notice of motion as well in the time we've got left, and time is running away with us. So Mr. Jenkins, please, and then Dr. Pollock.
Thank you, Chair. And I'm speaking on behalf of our group.
Thank you.
So current problems with bus services in Worcestershire include poor service, poor reliability, cuts to routes, and with subsidies going to bus companies who I think often have very little interest in the county. Over the past 10 years, bus journey numbers in Worcestershire have dropped from 17.2 million to 9.3 million. That's a drop of 46%. In Worcester, we lost the Park and Ride, which was the second most used bus service in the county. At the same time, we've got congestion that's worsening. We know that getting more people out of their cars and onto buses is key to tackling both climate change and air pollution. And the deregulation of buses has left us with a service that's too often expensive, slow, and unreliable. Bus travel has become far more expensive over the past decade. The supposed benefits of privatisation have failed to materialise. Bus companies have little incentive to improve a service, as they often have no competition for passengers. At present, we subsidise these private companies to keep buses going on unprofitable routes, whilst having little or no control over those same companies. So that's why I think franchising could well be the solution to the mess that we currently find ourselves in. We all know how this works in London, but many councillors, including myself, still researching, didn't know that actually Jersey introduced bus franchising in 2013. But 3 years later, they had reintroduced five new bus routes that increased the frequencies on several services. And perhaps most impressively of all, they actually saved £800,000 a year. So through franchising, we can start to plan buses as a network rather than as individual routes, bringing together socially necessary routes with busier commercial routes could ensure the long-term viability of the former. No rule says that franchising only works in cities, and Jersey has certainly shown that. Nor must franchising involve the local authority taking on revenue risk. In Jersey, this risk was shared between operator and local authority. Their direct experience of franchising has led them over time to develop a practical model that has proved an unqualified success. And I think we can learn from this. As I said, their passenger numbers have increased, subsidies decreased, customer satisfaction has gone up as well. So it clearly seems to be working. And I can certainly understand why maybe Worcestershire County Council may be concerned that managing a franchised operation would be expensive and technically challenging, particularly when they maybe look at how it works transport for London. But putting in both the strategic thinking and the effort at the early stage, Jersey has shown that ongoing management can be delivered with existing resources. And their report that I read about how it worked in Jersey concluded that we believe the Jersey model is fundamentally scalable. In fact, it would be almost certainly more cost effective at a larger scale. And as a consequence, we believe that sharing Jersey's story with authorities as they consider the powers given by the buses bill is both timely and useful. So to conclude, I think we can all agree that bus services in Worcestershire are nowhere near as good as we want them to be. And franchising can provide a solution, one that gives the council a greater say over how services are run. And this is essential for to persuade people to use buses rather than their cars, which is essential to our goal to be a carbon zero county. Franchising cannot happen overnight, and we'll need detailed planning, working together with partners to ensure that we create a franchising contract that works for Worcestershire. But as it's worked elsewhere, we can certainly one that we should investigate, and so worth asking for the power to do so. And we certainly cannot continue with the poor service we currently have. So this is a great opportunity to reimagine how an integrated public transport system can work in our county, and our group fully support this motion. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you, Mr. Jenkins. And I now call on Dr. Pollock and then Mr. Amos. Dr. Pollock, please.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Just a couple of very short points. Most of you will know that I represent the Tenbury division. I have 18 parishes around that. The idea that bus services could service everybody who lives there who wants to move is frankly ludicrous. Absolutely ludicrous. Obviously, what we've heard is, and some people think, that we as a public authority can do better than private industry. Very few examples of that across our society, I'm afraid. If the service is poor, it's because there is little demand. If you think that you can do better than the private organizations, well, fine, but probably at huge expense. There's Dear Fran says there are people on ships who want a bus at 5:30 in the morning. And where are they living? Are they all in one commune? Oh no, they're scattered all over Kidderminster. And they all want a bus at 5:30 in the morning. What rubbish. And what we started off was hearing about London. Oh, London has franchising. Let me remind you, the mayor of London, Sadiq Khan, is worried about subsidising the services in London, public transport services, and he has proposed a 9.5% increase in council tax. Never mind his boss saying zero, Sadiq Khan wants 9.5% to subsidise those wonderful franchised bus services. Need I say more?
Thank you, Dr. Pollock. And now it's Mr. Amos, please. I think you're speaking for the Conservative group.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Indeed I am. And I'm delighted we're having a debate about buses because Council will recall that with unanimous support, we recently adopted a new passenger transport strategy, which aims to expand the county's bus network by, in places, increasing frequencies, whilst in others, introducing new services where none currently exists, primarily through the use of demand-responsive community transport. To achieve this year's budget, I remind Council, contained an extra $750,000 to support subsidised bus routes, an increase of over 40%, which we have used to keep going services which otherwise would have been withdrawn, such as the 302, the 303 and the 202. This coming year, we're repeating the extra 10% on the subsidy, that's £200,000, and also carrying forward that part of the unspent $500,000 extra grant from this year's DFT. In addition, we're upgrading bus infrastructure with a huge rollout of real-time information boards at bus stops to enhance passenger confidence and convenience and improve punctuality and reliability. We continue to innovate and are planning to take over the full responsibility for bus shelters, given the current unsatisfactory division of responsibility with the districts. In fact, so far advanced are our plans that in Bromsgrove, we will be erecting a bus shelter powered by both wind and solar energy, the first such in the whole of Europe. We're constantly looking at new possibilities and funding opportunities as we applied for the all-electric bus town and rural mobility schemes. There is no doubt, Mr. Chairman, that bus travel is vital to a large section of the population. And before this lockdown, passenger numbers had risen to a healthy 48% of the pre-COVID level. This administration is completely committed to a healthy and vibrant bus network. And we see buses as the main and only effective alternative to the car. Specifically, Mr. Chairman, on this motion, the movers clearly and worryingly do not understand the legislation nor its implications. The Bus Services Act 2017, providing the option of franchising, is principally and primarily intended for mayoral authorities and has predominantly only been considered in urban areas with well-defined commercially viable networks, such as Manchester, Leeds and Middlesbrough. I can confirm with information both from the DFT and locally that no Shire counties in the country have shown any interest in this provision and no local authority at all has gone ahead with franchising with this provision, not one. The implications of applying for a franchise in Worcestershire, with its rurality and uncertain level of ridership in a large number of areas, will pose significant risks to the viability of the whole network. Worcestershire has only a few services that would be deemed as commercially profitable to the level required for operating a franchise. And indeed, most of those commercial services are on the cusp of being commercially viable. So the appetite for our bus operators to go head to head to win a franchise would be extremely low, or more likely, non-existent. Both pre-COVID, now and in the future, our operator provision is not in steady state and is extremely fragile. So introducing franchising will almost certainly destabilise the market further, probably to the point of collapse. The process of creating a business case to propose a new bus franchise, the Secretary of State would take up a great deal of time and money, and for a scheme where the benefits are at best minimal and unknown, but the adverse effects and disadvantages significant. A consultation exercise with current bus operators would be required. They would not support any such scheme, and this would severely undermine the good working relationship with them on a permanent basis and undermine the trust between us. Indeed, they may see it as an opportunity to offload some of the less commercially viable services onto us, creating an open-ended commitment financially, which would be irresponsible and impossible to budget for, leading to the wholesale withdrawal of services. If we did proceed, Mr. Chairman, we would need to commit to a long-term level of unaffordable funding and to setting up a new layer or section of bureaucracy to administer it, which would take vital money away from subsidising crucial bus routes. In short, Mr. Chairman, it is frankly impossible to see why our current bus operators
would be prepared to give the County Council a slice of their profits on commercially viable routes, which, as I have said, are at best vulnerable now. In other words, there is just no conceivable way whatsoever that they will pay Worcestershire County Council money to run a service. Both the market and bus operators in Worcestershire are highly fragile and volatile, to say the least, with profitability at the edge. The commerciality of the network in the county is too weak, and the timing of this proposal in the motion is remarkable for its insensitivity. If it were to proceed, and for the reasons I have outlined, Mr. Chairman, bus services would be decimated as current operators would likely withdraw from provision and there are no other operators waiting in the wings to take over from them. I repeat, the County Council is not allowed by law to run its own bus services, so the County Council is no substitute for any bus company that decides to withdraw.
Thank you, Mr.
This motion is ill thought out and betrays a worrying degree of ignorance and lack of understanding. I urge Council to vote against it to save Worcestershire's buses.
Thank you, Mr. Amos. And I'm very conscious of time, so I'm proposing just to take the three speakers whose hands are up. That's Professor Rain, Mr. Miller and Ms. Onslow. So, Professor Rain, and if you can keep it fairly short, we could get to a vote and perhaps onto the last item, please.
I'll be very short, Chairman. Councillor Pollock and Councillor Amos have expressed some severe reservations about this. I too have some reservations, but what I think both those contributions give insufficient consideration to is the reality is that the 1985 Transport Act, which is what deregulated buses services outside London in the first place, has been an absolute policy disaster. I think it's up there as the, you know, one of the great policy disasters. The idea was to revive the flagging fortunes of the bus industry, but quite the opposite has happened. And in our In London alone, London went up bus fares because of the Transport Act deregulation, affected travel everywhere except London, where quite the opposite happened, a 99% increase. So it was a good measure for urban areas for sure. What I think I hadn't heard said right today is the significant impact that bus patronage will have on the carbon footprint. That's something that doesn't really stack up in the comments that Councillor Amos and Councillor Pollock make. Buses are absolutely crucial. Public transport is absolutely crucial to that debate. And secondly, there is the issue about customer satisfaction. And there's what I get from my residents all the time is lack of satisfaction with the limited services that are available. So there is a problem here in Worcestershire. We do need to do something about it. And I support this motion at least because it does allow us to approach the problem of carbon and of customer dissatisfaction. Thank you, Chairman.
Thank you. Mr. Miller, please.
Thank you, Chairman. Well, I suppose I'm fortunate because I live in walking distance of an excellent bus service. And I can be guaranteed at any time I can walk up the road and I can find a seat on one of those buses where I like, because there are very few other people sat on the bus. When I used to walk down to the Park and Ride, when the Park and Ride was first launched, it was well supported. But over a period of time, the only time the Park and Ride was really well supported was first thing in the morning and last thing in the evening when people were returning from work. Other than that, those buses were travelling into Worcester and back with two or three people on. If you saw half a dozen people on, it was busy. Now, you cannot run a service unless people support it. So, and for the rural locations, and some of my rural point, Tiverton, Elmbridge and around there, if you saw a bus around Elmbridge, you get a report because they'd wondered what it was. So to think that we can actually have a franchise when you haven't got bums on seats, and that's what you need to make something successful. That's what the rail depend on, and that's what the buses depend on. If it's not supported, it cannot be commercially viable. Living when I walk the dog late at night, on the A38 and you walk up there, the bus travels by, you may get one person on the back of that bus. It will be cheaper for the bus company to get that person a taxi than a bus. So we do have to look at what we're doing and what we're asking for. Be careful what you ask for, I always think. So, and I think Alan Amos summed it up and Ken Pollock summed it up very well. I'll say no more.
Thank you, Mr. Miller. And Ms. Onslow, before we go to sum up, please.
Oh, thank you. Thank you very much, Chair. And I'm going to sound terribly parochial now, so excuse me for that. But can I please beg Council not to change the system now, because it's taken myself and Mark Garnier, the MP, since 2018 to get the bus returned to Habberley Estate, with the grateful thanks to Alan and his team for all their help with that. And I'd agree with Councillor Eyre that Alan Amos is the best Cabinet member that I've worked with in highways, but that isn't a high bar because I've only worked with one. But just to say thank you very, very much to them and that team for returning the bus to Habberley Estate. So for me, the system has definitely worked as it is. And I'm also very grateful to that team for extending the trial, because obviously it was set up as COVID started, so it wasn't really a true picture of usage. So I'm really glad for the fact that the trial has extended. But please, no change, because it's certainly working well for me in St John's. Thank you again.
Thank you. And can I ask Mr Denham to sum up, please, so we can get to the vote? Thank you.
Thank you, Chairman. Yeah. It was, I suppose, I guessed at the beginning that it would probably be voted down this by the ruling Conservative Party. Just one or two points I would make. I mean, Councillor Jenkins made the point that and the number of bus journeys made has gone down from 17.2 million down to 9.3 million. Councillor Miller's just recently made the point that people only use buses if they are viable. Well, the reply to that is, well, if buses are affordable, people will use them. And there's plenty of proof in London that they use because people can afford to get on them. Similarly, in the West Midlands as well, and lots of other areas. The reason why people don't use buses in this county is because they are too expensive, they're too infrequent, and they simply don't get people where they want to go. I have an essential worker living in my division who works in a nursing home, care home, in the other side of the river in St John's. She used to be able to get a bus from home, change in Crown Gate bus station, go out the other side and get to work for 7:30. We had first bus move the time of the first bus of the day, 20 minutes later. She can no longer make that connection and has to pay £10 a day for taxis now. Well, that's an hour's work, an hour's income for her. If she spends a week getting to work and back, she's having to work a whole shift just to pay the cost of the bus fares to get to work and back. Now, I want a way that will actually make things better for her and thousands of others like her. And if bus franchising is a possible way of doing it, then why not? We've been told by Councillor Amos that no Shire counties have yet applied for this. I thought we liked to be innovative in Worcestershire. I thought we liked to be world class. I thought we liked to do things quicker than everybody else. So let's just have a go, shall we? Why don't you just ask the question? And even if it doesn't get accepted by Grant Shapps, at least they'll know that we're serious about running buses efficiently in this county, because at the moment, there is no evidence that we are whatsoever. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you. And I think we can now move to the vote on this one. So I will ask Sheila Jones if she will deal with the Zoom poll, please.
Thank you, Chairman. I'm just launching the poll now on bus franchising. For, against or abstain, please. Just going to finish the poll now, Chairman.
Thank you.
And I'll share the results. 13 for, 33 against, and one abstention. So that's lost, Chairman.
Thank you, Sheena. Thank you for that. And I'm now looking at notice of motion 3, but I'm aware that we've only got something like 20 minutes to deal with it. But I'd like us to go ahead if I'm seeing that council are keen to go ahead there. So, okay then. So I invite the signatories to move and second. So that's Mr. Lunn and then Ms. Agar to second. Mr. Lunn, please.
Thank you, Chair. When a serving officer mentioned this important matter to me recently and asked if the County Council could assist in any way, I was only too happy to publicise a very important subject and seek to put the weight of this council behind the Commonwealth veterans at this current time. Having done research into the matter, I would explain that the subject concerns Commonwealth veterans who are not properly advised on their discharge from the forces. Having fought for our county, for our country, they face costs of over £2,000 per family member to apply for indefinite leave to remain. This has led to former soldiers being on the brink of deportation before being given leave to stay in the UK. I was shocked to learn that those who served in the forces do not get a waiver of costs when applying for indefinite leave to remain. Therefore, it can leave a family of four with costs of £8,000 to £10,000 just to apply to remain. We are not talking here about the odd isolated case. Around 500 veterans per annum from around the Commonwealth face these challenges, the vast majority of whom have served this country in some of the most dangerous places in the world, such as Afghanistan and Iraq. We as a council are committed to the Armed Services Covenant and therefore should be supporting veterans' rights. I have a very straightforward view that someone who has served for 4 years or more should be allowed to remain within the UK, and anyone who has laid their life on the line for 12 years or more should be rewarded with full UK citizenship. How can we ask someone to make the ultimate sacrifice for our liberties and then not show our gratitude or reward them by not automatically allowing them to remain in the UK? I remember about 11 to 12 years ago, the campaign which Joanna Lumley was very visibly involved in to allow Gurkhas to be allowed to stay here. That had great merits and was ultimately successful. And I hope similar pressure can be brought to ease the path of Commonwealth Armed Forces personnel. The Ministry of Defence do not appear to be following their own guidance, and the level of application fees is not unique in this case. I remember a General Synod motion a couple of years ago that highlighted the iniquity of someone having to pay £1,238 a time for a citizenship application. While accepting that there should be a handling charge, it did not seem appropriate for departments to be making a large profit from it. The representative from the armed forces highlighted the issues facing force personnel then, but things do not appear to have substantially improved. Leaving a calling like the armed forces is difficult and hard to adjust to at the best of times, particularly if you've been serving for a dozen years or more. However, returning to the substantive point of the motion, I will call on the leader of the council to write on our behalf to our MPs to highlight the challenges which the veterans are facing and call for a tweaking of existing legislation to ensure that veterans are treated fairly. I don't think there's any desire from any elected politicians to make the lives of these forces veterans more challenging. However, it is important to recognise when current processes are not working in the ways intended. To be prepared to give the ultimate sacrifice is a matter of admiration to us all. Therefore, if we are able to give of ourselves and assist these people in their hour of need, we should do everything we can. It's in that spirit I'm more than happy to accept the Conservative amendment. This is the last motion in this current council. I would hope that it's something which we can all unite behind and declare our unflinching support on this day. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Lunn. And I've just heard what you said. So what we're now saying is that the amended motion now becomes the substantial motion. Is that correct?
Correct, yes.
Yeah, thank you. And the seconder, I think, is Ms. Agar. And obviously, in seconding it, are you also accepting that the motion has now been changed?
Indeed, I am, Chair. Thank you. As a signatory of the Council's Armed Forces Covenant myself, and I notice on the screen a number of other signatories who were there on the day, this motion is dear to my heart. It's no secret that I and my late husband both came from armed forces families ourselves. So I genuinely feel a sense of comradeship with our armed forces veterans, and specifically, of course, on this occasion, including our Commonwealth veterans. Sadly, the majority of Commonwealth veterans do face considerable expense, as we've heard, and long waiting times when they apply to become UK citizens. And it seems to me that it should be a moral principle that when Commonwealth veterans have given so much to this country, and bear in mind many such veterans will have seen active service in war zones, risking not only their lives, but often with consequences for their physical and mental health as well, that they should then be asked to pay a fee to apply for citizenship. This motion seeks a change in legislation that honours their commitment and service to this country. We can show our support via this motion by seeking to remove the citizenship application fee and offer long-serving Commonwealth servicemen and women an automatic right to settle in the UK free of charge. Seems to me it's the least we can do. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that. And as usual, does Council wish this to be dealt with today? Yes, I'm seeing the nods. And in order that we can deal with it today, we've got probably less than 15 minutes left. So can I ask everyone to keep their comments short and to the point, please? So now open the debate. And the first speaker I have is Mrs. Zaborski and then Mr. Adams. Mrs. Zaborski.
Thank you, Chairman. I hope this motion is, as amended motion, is passed unanimously. Our armed forces depend on having a reasonably large number of Commonwealth citizens serving alongside our own citizens. And to me, it is just absolutely appalling that when somebody has put their life on the line for this country, we should then seek to charge them for the right to remain here once they've been they and their family have been discharged from our services. That dishonours us as a nation, and it's about time we put it right.
Thank you. And next speaker is Mr. Adams and then Mr. Morris. Mr. Adams.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm aware and very grateful to the Labour group for letting the wording go forward now. I understand that when I was going to put the amendment through, I had 5 minutes and now I believe I only have two. So I'll be as brief as I can. Mr. Chairman, I speak on behalf of Chairman of the Armed Forces Community Covenant Partnership, which I have chaired since 2012 when it first came about. And at that time, we only had about 6 members around the table. That is escalated now to about 30 people can turn up to a meeting from all over the country. Can I again thank the Labour group and their supporters? I'm not surprised that Pat Agar is in amongst that because she has always supported the armed forces and what we want to achieve. And I've always been grateful for that. But we have stood together on armed forces motions over the years that I have brought forward on various things, and we've always stood together. And to think, and I finish, this is the last time I shall speak to a motion at this council because I am not standing again, as many as you know. And obviously, the chairmanship will move into other people's hands, whoever comes forward or whatever happens there. So I am delighted that we hopefully will all stand together today on this, as we have done in the past. The thrust of this motion, there's no doubt that there's agreement across the political divide here on this one and the unfair treatment of the Commonwealth veterans, and it must be addressed and will be addressed. Where I struggled, and I tabled the motion as close to the original motion there, so as we could have consensus today on this one, where I struggle with some of the wording and looked at it and all the rest of it. But the points that aren't in the Labour motions that now we're going to support is the reference to the British Legion campaign. There's nothing in the original there. And obviously the reference to the Armed Forces Bill that is going through Parliament. It's important that we have that. And the importance to me, the word partnership has been so much in foremost in our minds about that. We couldn't go a yard for our veterans. And remember, there are over 20,000 in Worcestershire veterans to try and help and sort out their problems and all the rest of it. So the word partnership with wonderful partners like the British Legion, like SAFA, and I don't want to mention more, like the new Stepway, it does so much in Worcester. So there we are. I believe our armed forces champion can play a major part in the lobbying process. And I say that because we can get on with that straight away. On Monday, we have an armed forces meeting. We can make a start there. And it is only last week that I have the final champion in place for our district. So there are seven officers, myself at head of the county.
Thank you, Mr. Adams.
So with that, Mr. Chairman, I'm delighted from the response from the Labour Party. Let's stand together and get behind this amendment. Well, what is the motion before us this afternoon?
Thank you, Mr. Adams. And I now call Mr. Morris and then Mrs. Hodgson. Mr. Morris.
Thank you, Chairman. And it's always a privilege to follow Councillor Adams. He is a superb chairman and leader and advocate for the armed forces, and he will be missed in the role he's in now, but I hope he stays involved for many a time in the future. I'm really pleased to second the amendment. I am Wychavon's Armed Forces Champion. And it is in echo of the British Legion and what they are saying. And their words are, the UK recruits soldiers from across the Commonwealth to serve in our armed forces. Many of these soldiers leave behind family and friends to move across the world to serve the UK armed forces, becoming a backbone of our armed forces capability. There are currently over 6,000 personnel serving the UK armed forces from foreign and Commonwealth countries, with more being recruited each year to fill technical and specialist roles. From late 2018, and this was well publicised, Her Majesty's Forces has announced its intention to increase its reliance on Commonwealth personnel, with an aim to recruit 1,350 personnel a year. Now, it's also good news that Johnny Mercer, the Minister for Veterans Affairs in the Cabinet Office, has called on the Treasury to support the Commonwealth veterans who are forced to pay for visas to stay in the UK, and that's what we are hoping to agree with today. The Armed Forces Champions in Worcestershire, as Rob has mentioned, with the support of Rob himself and our officer, Kate Labar, have already worked well together to achieve success. With housing policy in South Worcestershire, we now have the armed forces in band one. We now have the criteria that includes physical health condition, which is attributable to their military service, and serious mental health conditions. So we've already have some success that will allow us to have that voice to move forward on this as well. As Rob said, we have a meeting next week, and I'm sure we'll discuss our stance and approach to our Commonwealth veterans, and I'm sure we'll be unanimous in supporting them, as I hope we are here today. So I second the amendment.
Thank you very much, Mr. Morris. And I now propose to take Mrs. Hodgson, Mr. Middleborough, and then I will ask Mr. Lund to sum up so we can go to the vote, and we'll just about get that in the time. So Mrs. Hodgson, please.
Thank you for that. I'm speaking on behalf of the Conservative group, and I echo Councillor Adams' words about thanking the Labour group for supporting our amendment to the motion. I think it is really important that it is the British Legion who is leading on this campaign, and we are keen to support their work in this matter. And also it should be noted that the response to the second reading of the Armed Forces Bill, which is going through Parliament at present. Under the chairmanship of Councillor Adams, we've had a very successful Armed Services Covenant Partnership. This has been supported, as we've heard, by the six Armed Forces champions who are based in each district and have been working with local organisations to support local issues, such as housing provision. Around the table at the partnership meetings, we have representatives of SAFA, British Legion, Age UK, NHS support, supporting forces families, representatives of the local armed forces, and also Combat Stress and Stepway, who are supporting veterans across Worcester and Worcestershire. All have been supported by the excellent work of Kate LeBarry. I want to just take a moment to thank Councillor Adams for his support and guidance over the years. You will be sadly missed from the work of the partnership. And really, thank you to the Labour Party for allowing me to say these words to Councillor Adams as well. I know we have the correct people around the table to lobby for the support of the veterans. And I too will be at the meeting on Monday. And I too believe, and I believe that the armed forces champions are the correct ones to be lobbying their local MPs because they understand the message that they need to get across. So I support this motion.
Thank you. And just Mr. Middleborough to speak, and then Mr. Lund to sum up, please.
Thank you, Chairman. I'm going to address it slightly differently to what's been said already. I look back when I used to look out of my house windows in Portrush, County Antrim, Northern Ireland, in the early 1970s. Daily, I saw troops crawling along the pavement, knowing they were protecting me and my neighbours from terrorist attack. No one questioned the citizenship of those heroes there crawling along the pavement at that time. They were facing death on a daily basis. Those heroes who from the Commonwealth deserve a free citizenship for them and their family to remain in the United Kingdom, where they've supported the United Kingdom for all the time they were in the forces. So let's go behind the British Legion and let's fully support the campaign here. I must quickly just say something about Rob Adams. I recall many years ago when he was elected as a district councillor for Norton and then the county councillor for Norton, we had a little conversation, I think, at one stage, and I said to Rob, you represent the Worcestershire Regiment because you represent the home of the Worcestershire Regiment. He hasn't always taken notice of everything I've said, but on this occasion, he certainly did take notice. And wow, we launched a missile with Rob on this, didn't we? Thank you, Chairman.
Thank you there. And now I ask Mr. Lund to sum up so we can go to the vote, please.
Well, thank you, Chair. I think all I'd like to add is thank everybody that's spoken within this debate. I think we've got pretty uniform agreement. Apologies, Councillor Adams, for depriving you of a longer speech, but I think we're all very much coming in the same direction. And I think it's important from time to time to highlight where there are administrative issues and quirks which perhaps shouldn't be there and they need to be brought to attention so that the matters can then be resolved. But I urge uniform support for this afternoon. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Lund. And now we'll ask Sheena Jones to deal with the poll, please.
Thank you, Chairman. I'm launching the voting now. I think everybody has now voted, so I'll end the polling and share the results. Have 45 in favour, 1 against and 1 abstention, Chairman.
Thank you, Sheena. Thank you very much for that. So again, the motion is clearly carried. Now I'll move us rapidly on to agenda item number 8, question time. And please turn to pages 47 to 48 in the main agenda and 61 sent separately for question time. There are 5 questions. As usual, I will take 1 question from each member and return for any second question. I wish to stress that a supplementary question may only be asked with the chairman's consent and if it arises directly out of the original question or the response. Will members please bear in mind this is an opportunity to ask a question, not make a speech. And 30 minutes has been allowed today for this. All the questions are on the council's website, so there's actually no need to read out your question. And written answers will be circulated to all members and will appear on the website at all. So if I may, the first question is from Mrs. Zaborski for Mr. Amos. Are you happy to take it as read, please, Mrs. Zaborski?
Yes, I ask question 1 as printed.
Thank you, Mr. Amos, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I thank Councillor Zaborski for her question regarding the traffic lights at the A449, A448 junction, Kidderminster. The introduction of a right turn filter on these lights was considered in 2014 as a proposed safety improvement. The traffic signal modelling showed a very high increase in AM peak delays per vehicle, 170% on Chester Road North and 194% on Comberton Road West. There are also significant increases in delay on other arms and during the PM peak. At 20 to 30%, though, not as dramatic. Due to the impact on congestion and delay, the recommendation is not to implement a right-turn filter. The manoeuvre in question does have road markings and a stop line mid-junction to remind right-turn drivers they must give way. The introduction of very long delays, such as those modelled, do have safety consequences, with drivers possibly becoming frustrated and then more likely to run a red light. As the implementation of a right-turn filter requires a signal remodel at a cost of around £12,000, such a proposal is not recommended as a trial. However, I would stress that it is the negative impact on both congestion and safety, rather than the cost, that is the main determining factor here. There have been two casualty accidents recorded for the last 3 years, 1st of January 2018 to 31st of December 2020. One, a vehicle ran a red light colliding with a vehicle mid-junction. And second, a right-turn collision on the A448 Cobberton Hill West, turning into the A449 Chester Road South. Of course, having said that, I'm very happy to reconsider the matter if Councillor Aborsi can give me some new compelling information which would affect this analysis and conclusion.
Thank you. Mrs. Aborsi, do you have a supplementary question? You're on mute, Mrs. Aborsi.
My colleague, Councillor Tracy Onslow, shares my concern. I know about this. There are quite regular minor shunts at this site, even though they're not serious injury accidents. And in view of the fact that there are some 800 to 900 young people at King Charles High School coming out there, please will the cabinet member come and meet us on site once lockdown has stopped and see the problem for himself?
If I may answer that, Mr. Chairman. Yes, I'll be very happy to do a site visit. I'm very happy to do that. If Councillor Borsley can remind me at the appropriate time, I'll be very happy to come out and have a look.
Thank you for that. And I'll move us then on to question number two from Mrs. Brunner. And that is again for Mr. Amos. And can we take that as read, please?
Yes, question as read, please, Chairman.
Thank you. Mr. Amos.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I thank Councillor Brunner for her question. And I would like to take this opportunity to acknowledge what a tremendous champion she has been for the residents of her division over the years. And I can tell her she will be missed by a lot of us, me in particular, but I know many others. LED light emitting diodes have many benefits over the existing non-LED lamp sources, ranging from their longevity to their durability. Some of these benefits include: LED lights depreciate at a much slower rate than other alternative lamp sources. They are light emitting diodes, so they do not have filaments or burn out quickly and have extremely long lives. They contain no toxic chemicals, unlike the sodium lamps that they are replacing. Reduce maintenance costs, as they do not require regular bulk lamp changes as previous lamp sources required. The long life of LEDs, particularly in areas where it is difficult for our street lighting contractors to access, such as divorced footpaths, will be hugely beneficial when these locations are converted. LED lanterns do not produce a lot of heat. They use significantly less energy, and this is reducing the County Council's overall energy consumption and carbon footprint. The light control of the modern LED lanterns being fitted is excellent and results in minimal light spill onto nearby properties and into the night sky. Much improved colour rendering as compared to sodium lighting. And they are available in a range of different colours to suit a range of environmental issues, including a number of different white colour temperatures, i.e. cool, neutral or warm. Red LEDs have been installed in areas where there are known populations of bats, which are averse to white light sources. So there can also be important ecological advantages by changing over to LED. As for how many LED columns have been installed since 2017, I can confirm to Councillor Brunner the following. Arrow Valley East, we do not hold data by division, but by town. Secondly, Redditch. The latest figures show that we have installed 4,268 LED lanterns in Redditch out of a total of approximately 9,600 streetlights. And thirdly, Worcestershire, the rollout of LEDs continues throughout the county, the latest total being 24,992. And by the end of today's meeting, it's probably nearer 25,000. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you for that, Mr. Amos. Mrs. Brunner, do you have a supplementary question?
Yes. When will the LED colours come in pink?
I'm not sure that warrants an answer, Ms. Famos.
Sooner the better.
The question. Okay, then I'll move on to the third question, which is from Mr. Lunn for Mr. Geraghty. And again, can we take that as read, please? Mr. Lunn?
Indeed. Sorry, I was nodding at you. Yeah, indeed.
Oh, sorry, I couldn't see you on the screen. Thank you. Mr. Geraghty, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Firstly, can I thank Robin for his question? It's a thought-provoking one. Looking back over the council term, I had anticipated that we'd be able to make more progress in securing the national long-term funding solution for adult social care. As colleagues know, protecting the most vulnerable in society is a key priority for everybody on this council, and we've invested considerable sums over the lifetime of council to ensure that we meet this demand-led service, now spending some 40% plus of our net budget on adult social care alone. However, through the County Council network, we will continue to press the issue, and I hope post-COVID that the government will address this issue, which I know will be most welcomed by all members.
Thank you. Mr. Lund, did you have a supplementary question?
I thank the leader for that answer. I think I would just be very quick supplementary insofar as why does he think that the government hasn't, conscious of the pressure coming from himself and other council leaders, why does he think that the government hasn't addressed this in the way that he and others would hope?
Thank you, Robin. I think adult social care is a complex matter, and its interrelationship with health is also key in terms of the kind of service that we wish to see in the future. For adult social care and the issues around not just funding, but eligibility, et cetera. So I think COVID has got in the way in the last year, clearly, but there's been other matters before that in terms of reaching some form of cross-party agreement on adult social care. I think this council, very much across the spectrum, wants to see that, wants to make sure that we've got a national long-term funding solution for adult social care. So we will certainly lobby through CCN, which is a cross-party body as well. CCN has done a good piece of work actually just recently that they're putting out in relation to social care. So we will continue to press the matter, and I very much hope to see progress obviously in the next term of the council.
Thank you, Mr. Geraghty. And we'll move on now to question number four, which is also from Mrs. Zaborski, but it's for Mr. Roberts. Again, can we take that as read, please? Thank you.
Yes.
Mr. Roberts.
Thank you, Chair. It is. It's a good question. It's a very complicated answer, I'm afraid. And I'm going to go on just a little bit because it does get confusing. If we look at nationally, in the first three months of 2020, actually the number coming into care went down by 6%. But there was also a decrease in the number of children leaving care by about 10%. The Association of Directors of Children's Services, the ADCS, is reporting that there is a national increase in children community care, but we haven't got that data at the moment. Other information nationally is that the research of Women's Resource Centre found that there were more babies coming into care, and it was supposed that that was as a result of increase in domestic violence as a result of, lockdown, they came out of lockdown. And there's also information, Bernardo cited a 44% increase in the rise of demand for foster carers, while those willing to foster care was actually decreasing by something like a half. So nationally, the ADCS says that we'll be seeing increases in the referral of children going into social care, children in need, Section 47, that's where a child has to come into care because it's suffering risk, children on child protection plans and looked after children. And they reckon the only way to overcome this, not overcome it to help with this, is ability to stabilise and rebuild early help and maintain strong leadership and system-wide approaches. Fran will know that that's what we've been doing for 3 years. In fact, she's been part of that process. If you look locally, and I ought to do that because we are corporate parents and we're interested in our children. We have a lower rate of children coming into care this year. That's we received 135 new entrants compared to 159 in the same period last year. So we've not seen an excessive demand for care during the pandemic. But there has been a change, a disturbing change, really. Our new starters reflect this national thing where there's been an increase in babies that's 0 to 2 years who are coming into care. At one time, they comprised 29%. Now they're 39% of the children coming into care. The care, those coming into care 11 over hasn't changed much, 38% of the total compared to 36. I know Fran's always particularly interested in Section 20 children. For those, the uninitiated, those are ones who are coming into care with the arrangements of their parents. But here, we're at a stable 12%, which is a low figure when compared with our statistical neighbours of 21%. So that's good news, but there's some things we can't control. We've got less control in the rise of unaccompanied asylum-seeking children. And based on quarter three, this rose from 5% of the total coming into care to 12% in 2021. So that's children coming into care. Those leaving care, we have a slightly better than average performance against our statistical neighbours for children leaving care, 19.8 per 10,000 compared with 18.7. So if you put those together, our number in care, and it's high at the moment, 846 children in care at February. It continues to rise, but we remain, we're controlling things through our edge of care and permanency planning. So there's fewer people coming into care compared with our neighbours. So we should see that gap in the national averages decrease. I want to say that data, I think, shows an early but tangible sign of the strength of our strengthening families first strategy that Fran will know all about. Others might not know quite so much about, but just as a reassurance to everyone, the person who led on that was Tina Russell, who's taken over as our Director of Children's Services at the moment. So with an effective model and support for the budget, I've got to say, I was disappointed we didn't get support for the budget because I outlined the increase that was going in and the contingency. I was disappointed that wasn't supported, but we got it through. And so with that, in the future years, I believe that we have some rigidity. This is in the future year. What I can't do, I really can't do, is I can't look 12 months hence. That would need more than a crystal ball. With all these, COVID will cast a long shadow. And I, at the moment, can't see what that will mean. But for the immediate future, within the scope of our budget and in what we're doing at the moment, there is resilience. Sorry it's taken so long, Chair.
Very comprehensive answer, Mr. Roberts.
Yes, thank you. Very comprehensive answer, no supplementary.
Thank you for that, Mrs. Zaborski. So we move on to the last question. From Mr. Morris, and it's for Mr. Amos. And again, Mr. Morris, if we can take that as read.
We can, thank you.
Mr. Amos. Oh, you're on mute, Mr. Amos.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Normally, that's just wishful thinking, but you're absolutely accurate. I'll start again. I thank Councillor Morris for his question and indeed for his determination in pursuing this very important scheme with me. An options assessment report for the Westlands Junction in Droitwich was completed in 2020, which considered different options for pedestrian crossings at Westlands Roundabout. Several options were considered, all of which proposed pedestrian movements via the use of toucan crossings, additional footways and/or signalisation of certain roundabout arms. The indicative cost of a scheme involving the provision of two toucan crossings, improvements to and upgrading of the footway to 3 metres shared width, lighting and drainage is approximately £465,000. This costing is an estimate only at this stage and obviously would be confirmed as the scheme develops.
options have been explored for funding a scheme, including existing funds such as the Worcestershire Network Efficiency Programme. However, as the roundabout does not experience congestion, this funding is not available. So alternative sources of funding from local development will have to be sought. The SWDP, the South Worcestershire Development Plan, is currently being reviewed, with final site selection subject to confirmation. I'm pleased to say that there are three proposed employment land allocations which could be linked to a scheme on the Westlands roundabout as an enhanced pedestrian route between the employment sites, residential areas and the town centre. Two are new allocations and one is a reallocation from the current SWDP. This will be linked to the transport modelling for the SWDP review, which the County Council's consultants are currently carrying out to enable a Westlands scheme to be included within the SWDP review infrastructure delivery plan. And the SWDP 2 is timetabled for adoption in 2023. At the same time, other potential sources of funding will also be explored and the Westlands scheme included in future delivery plans for other relevant documents as these are refreshed. So I think cautiously encouraging news for Councillor Morris there, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much, Mr. Amos. And Mr. Morris, do you have a supplementary?
If I may, I really welcome the response from Councillor Amos, and I do appreciate his support in trying to bring a solution here and the officers as well. You talked about congestion and the South Worcester Development Plan, which I agree are the right ways to address it. But I would also like to look at connectivity and active travel. Yeah, this is a site that is alienated somewhat from the town and it needs support to connect it. We know it has a deprived status and it really is important that we invest to bring it into the heart of the town. And I would ask that we pursue that agenda as well, please.
Thank you, Councillor Morris. Mr. Amos, had you...
Yes, I think it's a very thoughtful suggestion, actually, Mr. Chairman. I mean, we have looked at the active travel option in terms of can it bring in funds to assist with a scheme like this. But I haven't given up on that. So certainly I can assure Councillor Morris, we will look at every option funding to make sure this scheme goes ahead. He's absolutely right. It's a deprived area. People therefore will disproportionately be relying on walking and good pavements and crossings and so on. So I fully take that on board and I can guarantee we will do our best.
Thank you very much, Mr. Amos. There be no more questions. I'll move us on to agenda item 9, reports of committees. And the first one is the Pensions Committee. Please turn to pages 49 and 50. And I will invite Mr. Paul Middleborough, the chairman of the Pensions Committee, to present the report. And then I will invite the council to note the report. Mr. Middleborough will answer any questions if necessary. Mr. Middleborough.
Thank you, Chairman. I present the report of the meeting, which was there to give the county's shareholder, who was going to go to the annual general meeting of the Local Government Pension Scheme Central, advice as to how to cast votes. I'll answer any questions, sir.
I'm not seeing any hands up, so unless anyone has any questions, we will note your report. Thank you. And we'll move on to the next item. Please turn to page 51. And I will invite Mr. Rob Adams, the chairman of the Planning and Regulatory Committee, to present the report. I will invite council to note the report. And again, Mr. Adams will answer any questions if necessary. Mr. Adams, please.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, I present the summary of the Planning and Regulatory Committee held on the 2nd of February. Although it's just a small few lines on this, we deliberated over this application for about an hour and three quarters. It's just small text there, it was a very large application that will greatly improve the traffic flows on that area. And very much the committee wanted to support the very hardworking county council in that area by getting the information forward as that development progresses in that area. And to that end, we decided to condition a liaison group to keep everybody informed. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Adams. And yes, it was quite a long and detailed scrutiny because I was at that committee. I'm not seeing any hands up. So again, we will note your report. Thank you very much. And I'll move on to the last report to committees, the Standards and Ethics Committee. And this is on your pages 53 and 54. And I will invite Mr. McKay, the chairman of the Standard and Ethics Committee, to present the report. And then I will invite council to note the report. And again, Mr. McKay will answer any questions if necessary. Mr. McKay.
Yeah, thank you, Chairman. Yeah, happy to present the report. The committee considered the Local Government Association Member Code of Conduct and made appropriate suggestions in relation to it. The only other addition I should make to the report is, and I thank one of my colleagues for pointing out the omission, at paragraph 4, the number of formal complaints for 2018 was missing. In fact, the number should be 9. Happy to present the report.
Thank you very much. And again, I'm not seeing any hands up. So again, I will invite council to note the report. Thank you very much. And really that, with that, it concludes the business for today and the last meeting of this current council. But before I formally close the meeting, I would like to thank all those members and officers who have worked tirelessly together so that Worcestershire County Council could continue to function safely, as it should, despite the restrictions imposed upon us by COVID-19. All the meetings during my term of office have been virtual, and although this chain is real, I've only ever been able to sit in this virtual chair, which actually doesn't exist in my study. Perhaps when things return to normal, I might sneak into the chamber and just try out the real one. I'd like to thank all members for their contributions to meetings and wish everyone well. I note that some long-serving members of this council have indicated they will not be standing for re-election. On behalf of us all, I would like to thank Councillor John Smith, who has served, I gather, since December 1996, and Councillor Liz Tucker, who has served since May 1981, and also, of course, Councillor Rob Adams. I thank them all for their service to this council and to our community. I'd also like to thank our officers, committee officers, Sheena Jones and Simon Lewis, who, believe me, have worked very hard behind the scenes in their virtual world to make everything run as smoothly as it has for all of these Zoom meetings, including today. And so I now formally close this meeting. Please get your jab when you can. Observe the COVID restrictions and please stay safe, everyone. Thank you.
Thank you, Chairman.